They call it the loveliest village, Auburn, Alabama. We're at Jordan Harris Stadium. Tennessee and Auburn, one of the great rivalries in the Southeastern Conference. Hello again, everybody. I'm Corey McFerrin. Bo Jackson era is over. The quality football continues at Auburn. They're ranked number 8 in the country, but their approach offensively is different this year. Bo Jackson, of course, a legend, a folk hero here at Auburn, the Heisman Trophy winner, leading rusher of all time at Auburn, one of the finest all-around collegiate athletes ever. So talented, in fact, that Bo spurned a pro football career for baseball. Bo no longer carries the ball. He hits it and far for the Kansas City Royals. So, with the big guy gone, what is Pat Dye to do? Would you believe throw the football?
Well, if we can be effective throwing the football in normal situations, running situations, and we can maintain being a physical football team with a running game, then it's got to make us a better offensive football team. And that's what we're striving for right now. We've been effective against Chattanooga and East Carolina, but we haven't played a football team with the caliber of athletes that Tennessee's got. So we'll just see how far we are along today. And we may end up running the ball more than we had planned to, or we may end up throwing the football more than we planned to. We'd like to keep it balanced.
As for the defending SEC champions, University of Tennessee Volunteers, no major plans are changed this year, but Johnny Majors doesn't have a problem. He's already lost one SEC game.
For us to be a contender, at least maybe for a tie, possible tie in case some other teams lose, we have to win the Auburn game to stay in the conference race. If we lose it, we're pretty much out of it, unless there's an unusual situation where teams would tie for the championship with two losses.
Johnny Majors and the Vols against Pat Dye and the Tigers. First, Jim Lampley after this. C Sports presents. CFA College Football. From Auburn, Alabama, it's the Auburn Tigers against the Tennessee Volunteers. Pat Dye's Tigers, long known for a powerful ground game, have rediscovered the pass. Quarterback Jeff Berger, the principal figure, up top for nearly 500 yards in Auburn's first two games. Berger ranked second in the nation in passing efficiency and already has connected on 5 touchdown passes. As for Tennessee, it's defense. Preseason All-American Dale Jones and most of the wrecking crew responsible for destroying Miami at the Sugar Bowl are back for more. It's the Tigers and the Vols. 91 degrees, a boiling hot afternoon at Auburn, Alabama. The rivalry is just as hot. Tennessee and Auburn, the place is rocking. Auburn has the advantage over the years over Tennessee. Last year, of course, Tennessee knocked off then number one ranked Auburn at Knoxville. Corey McFerrin along with you once again, along with Lynn Swann, our color analyst today. And Lynn, Pat Dye talks about the past, but you don't suppose he's going to forget about the run just yet, is he?
I doubt very seriously that Pat would ever forget about the run. And if they're going to run, and the real weight is going to fall on their All-American and Outland Trophy candidate, Ben Tamborello at center. He is a big, strong man. He is consistent. He is dedicated. And he has been overwhelming in the first two games. If they're going to throw the football, Tennessee's outside linebacker, Dale Jones, is going to have a great impact in this ball game. He was terrific in the Sugar Bowl against Miami when he threw Vinny Testaverde for several losses in that ball game.
Now, Tennessee offensively is hurt by the absence of tailback Keith Davis out with a knee injury. Will not see action today, but they do have a fella who can run pretty well.
His name is William Howard. They have him listed at 225 pounds, but I think he's more like 235. He was a tailback in high school and would like to be one here again. So when we talked to him, we asked him if having a good game here would have an impact.
There'll be some biased opinions about whether William Howard plays fullback or William Howard plays tailback, but I think I'm more concerned about winning. I think for our team to win, I don't know if the coaches will play me a fullback, tailback, wherever I think I can help the team, or wherever the coaches feel I can help the team. I think that's best for our team, and that's most important overall over my individual statistics.
You know, this Auburn passing attack we're talking about is no fluke. Jeff Berger has already had two 200-yard passing performances, something that has not been done since the Pat Sullivan era. Pat Sullivan is his coach now. We asked Jeff about the passing attack.
Well, it made me feel good. I mean, knowing that Coach Sullivan was coming in, I mean, I knew that, there's no reason for him to be here. to coach wishbone quarterbacks. And I knew we was going to a pro-type offense, and, you know, I was thrilled to death with it. And so far, I think everybody likes what we're doing. That's the main thing that's kind of different from last year. I think offensive linemen are happy with what we're doing, yeah, and the backs and the receivers are. So, you know, if you're happy and you're out there having fun, then that makes a difference.
I think fundamentally, you know, Jeff doesn't have a great arm, but he's got a good arm, and he's got the tools to do it. And it just took a little while for him mentally to pick it up. And again, give Coach Dye credit, because when we first started early, we weren't very good at it. And he hung with us in our practice and made the commitment that that's what we were going to do. And so it's just turned out fine so far.
Now, obviously, the outcome of this game does not hinge entirely on the play of the skilled people alone. We've got some monsters along the line of scrimmage. Mike Adamly is here now to tell us about a couple people to watch. Mike?
Well, Corey, one matchup we haven't mentioned yet involves Tennessee's offensive all-SEC offensive right tackle, Bruce Wilkerson. He'll be going against Auburn's left tackle, defensive left tackle, Tracy Rocker, who may be the best defensive player on the field this afternoon. He's just a sophomore, but he led the Tigers in tackles as a freshman a year ago. He's not an All-American yet, but he's our vote. He gets our vote to make the All-Name team. I'm sure before the day is over, Rocked by Rocker will be rolling off your lips. Have fun with it, Corey and Lynn.
Tracy Rocker. The Auburn Tigers try to win their first SEC game of the year. Tennessee tries to even up their conference mark at one apiece. The kickoff coming up.
CFA College Football. This ABC Sports exclusive is brought to you by Nissan. Test drive the new Nissan hard body trucks at your Nissan dealer now. By Radio Shack, the computer experts. By the U.S. Armed Forces, it's a great place to start. And by Michelob Light, who says...
It's even warmed up 2 degrees to 93. It's going to be a hot one all afternoon. Tennessee will kick off to Auburn. Tommy Agee back at his own 5-yard line. 72,000 plus on hand at Jordan-Hare Stadium. And here we go. Carlos Revee, the kick. Bouncing into the end zone. So Auburn will take over on the 20-yard line. Their offense, the man to watch, the center, the Outland Trophy candidate, Ben Tamborello. In the backfield, Tommy Agee, a four-year veteran. Of course, that quarterback, Jeff Berger, first man to throw back-to-back 200-yard-plus games since the Pat Sullivan era of the early 70s. Berger, your quarterback. Behind him in the backfield. Berger will pass immediately. That's Tommy Agee across the 20, 25-yard line. First down to the 38-yard line before he's taken out there by Byron Hunt, or Brian Hunt. So a big gainer to open it up for Auburn, Tommy Agee. Tennessee's defense among the down linemen, Mark Hovenak. He leads Tennessee in big plays, a sack and three tackles. And here's a guy that Johnny Major says is the toughest player ever to perform at the University of Tennessee, Cale Jones, the outside linebacker. First and 10 from the 38-yard line. Pitch to Jesse. Cut back towards midfield. Up close to the 45-yard line, where he's tackled by Terry Brown and Fred Bennett.
Pat Dye was a man of his word, coming out with the first play of the ball game being a pass. I think that second play and the back going, cutting way across the field to get back to the center line will tell you something about the respect they have for the right side. When you're in trouble, a back always runs back to the strongest part of the offensive line.
The second and 3. Auburn will use this formation in short yardage situations. Reggie Ware stacked up big. Dale Jones, the man we referred to a moment ago from Cleveland, Tennessee, the right outside linebacker, is there to stack Reggie up.
Take another look at it. See the play going just off tackle to the right, and right there, Dale Jones does a good job. Now everyone in front of him is off defensive line, just filled in the gaps. It was his responsibility to come in that offside position. He does it, makes a stop, and then waits for help.
All right, and 3rd and 3, the full house backfield once again. Tommy Agee, right side,
diving, and I think he's got the first down, but there is a flag on the play. Fred Bennett is there for the stop by Tennessee. Holding against Auburn. Against Auburn. The Tigers, of course, last year, major disappointment up at Knoxville. They were the number one ranked team in the country. Tennessee came in, knocked them out 38-20. We asked a lot of the players the last couple days here in Auburn, is that a motivational factor? Most would not admit that it really is, but I got to believe out here today, occasionally that might come to mind. Don't you think, Lynn?
Holding. Offense. Still third down.
Absolutely. I think it becomes a big motivational factor for Auburn. There's Johnny Mazes. He also coached at the University of Pittsburgh, but I was playing football there at Pittsburgh. But they want revenge for taking away a national championship here in Auburn.
It's third and 13 after the penalty ball at the 34-yard line. Berger, a lot of pressure, weaving his way out. He's going to run it, and he's going to be tackled at the 42-yard line, way short of the first down yardage.
Number
Kelly 70, Ziegler was there.
Number 74, Brian Hunt, the middle guard, is there putting a great deal of pressure on Berger. Berger did a very good job of just stepping into the pocket and finding a little bit of open room.
Brian Schulman punting for Auburn. It's a good punt back to the 10-yard line. That is Thomas Woods, who was upended immediately at the 15-yard line. Tennessee's offense will take over at the 15-yard line. Wilkerson, Bruce Wilkerson, the right tackle, second-team All-American in the backfield. Francis, Jeff Francis, standing at the job done today. He's had a hurt shoulder. There was some question earlier in the week if he'd be able to play today. He's from Mount Prospect, Illinois. In motion, Anthony Miller, number 7, as Francis says, get going the other way, partner. Handoff, that's the big man, William Howard. And he bangs his way up close to first down yardage. Auburn defense. Now, in the secondary, Tom Powell, he's all SEC, preseason All-American, top tackler in that secondary. But Tracy Rocker, 6'3", 258. Preseason All-SEC as a freshman last year. He led Auburn in tackles. Second and one. Tennessee 1 yard shy of the first down of a 9-yard carry by William Howard. Handoff this time. That's Jim Miller, the big fullback, who bowls his way across for first down yardage. He's hit there by Nate Hill.
Let me set up what I think is going to be an interesting confrontation throughout the ball game here, Corey. When William gets a ball and carrying it, he's carrying the ball and he's weighing 235 pounds. Linebacker's going to have to do the stopping. The question is, can he stop him and then get help? Because the linebackers for Auburn are 212, 228, 210, and 235. So William's got the advantage.
Miller and Howard in the backfield to give to Miller, the big fullback, across the 30 to the 33-yard line. So Miller carries twice in succession. Miller, mostly known as the big blocking fullback, has not carried all that much this year. 8 times for 42 yards before this game, as a matter of fact. It's second and 4. Crushed on the left side. Big Nate Hill. Nate Hill, number 99, out of LaGrange, Georgia. And here's a kid who, off a tremendous performance last week, has won a starting spot. He had 12 tackles against East Carolina.
He stopped here, but look at the power he has when he hits his people. Look at that Auburn helmet just snap back. And if he can keep doing this throughout the afternoon, he's going to wear those young boys down.
At 184 yards 2 weeks ago against Mississippi State. Francis sending Terrence Cleveland another foot or two outside. Third and 2, he puts it up and it's overthrown. That ball intended on the far side for Clinscales. Joey Clinscales, the outstanding split in for Tennessee. So Auburn holds.
Auburn did a good job. Tennessee will call a lot of plays, audible a lot of plays at the line of scrimmage. That time, I think Auburn gave them a bad read and was able to stop them on that play.
Back to punt for Tennessee, Bob Garman. He has a 43.4 average so far this year. And interestingly enough, you know where Bob's from? Birmingham, Alabama. Craig Gaines knocked out at the 40-yard line. So Auburn will try to get their offense in gear from their own 40. There's no score early in the first quarter from Auburn, Alabama. You know, Tennessee won their first SEC title since 1969 last year, but as this graphic indicates, the Volunteers have been at the top in the SEC over the years. Very clearly number two overall in winning percentage. Tennessee with 9 SEC titles overall. Auburn with only 2 through the years. Berger from the 40. Sees nothing and loses about 3 yards. And Dale Jones, the linebacker we've been talking about, is the man to bring him down.
And he was right there. We'll take a look at it again. He's getting pretty good protection here, but just look at the pressure coming through from the outside, from the inside. Now he decides he's got to run with the football, but it's too late. Dale's right there to capitalize on the move inside.
Berger had 245 yards in the air against the University of Tennessee, Chattanooga, 219 yards up top against East Carolina. But Tennessee is a step above UTC and East Carolina. Here they give. That's Tommy Agee. Big gainer across midfield to the 40, to the 37-yard line, where he's driven out of bounds by Terry McDaniel. Tommy Agee, the big senior, 5'11", 211 pounds, preseason All-SEC selection.
When you look at this, look at number 55, the linebacker. He moves right inside there, and he's carrying out the assignment. This play was designed for that kind of stunt by the Tennessee defense. Great call by the offensive coach who put that play in there. The defensive alignment created the hole for Tommy Agee to get the big game.
A 26-yard pickup by Agee. Ball at the 37-yard line. And slides his way up near the 30-yard line, where McDaniel again makes a stop for Tennessee.
Once again, he stated at the top of the show that the strength is in the center of the offensive line. You see right there, he's going straight up the middle. Whoop! At the offensive line, they fired up. The only reason why there are orange jerseys there is because they were coming in from the outside. I think he's going now to attack the middle of this Tennessee defense because he's going to have more success.
Hand off. Tommy Agee again plowing through, and Auburn, as we suspected, trying the middle of that line, trying to push that ball across.
Now, the long-term effect of running up the middle is going to create better opportunities for Auburn to run to the outside, to run their play-action passes, because it's going to hold the linebackers.
First down on the Agee run as Auburn's offense is moving the football. Forward. This time, nothing. Taken down there by Ziegler. Kelly Ziegler, the linebacker out of Miami, Florida.
Number 22, Brent Fullwood, may just be the very best tailback, but I talked with Coach Dye as to why he wasn't playing more often. He said he came into training camp late because of several personal problems he was having. He had to make sure that he was academically eligible, so he was in school, so he missed a lot of time. He says, when this man is ready, and when he shows the discipline, I'll put him in there more often.
He averaged more than 7 yards a carry last year. That's better than Bo Jackson. Berger to the air, to the corner of the end zone, and he overthrows his man. That ball intended for Lawyer Tillman, the split in out of Mobile.
Keep our eyes on Lawyer Tillman. He stands about 6'3", 6'4", and he's going against a very small cornerback in Peppers, who's only about 5'10". So I anticipate seeing some plays throughout this afternoon where they're just going to match up height against no height.
There's Pat Dye. Last 4 years with 37 victories. His club, the third winningest team in the nation in that span, tied with SMU. 3rd and 7. Berger, the option. The pitch back, Agee. About the 18-yard line. Bennett is in there along with Dale Jones and Terry McDaniel, and they snuff that play out in a hurry.
When you're going against an option, you give the quarterback one read, hope he takes it, and then let him make his move, and then you defense that particular move. I think he just pitched the ball too soon here. There are two people on the outside. The defensive line has great lateral pursuit.
So Chris Knapp is on, attempting a 26-yard field goal. Brian Schulman, the holder. It is up and good. So Knapp hits his second field goal on the year. And Auburn is on the board first here at Jordan Harris Stadium. It's 3-0 Tigers. All right, Jim, here at Auburn, Alabama, the Tigers with a 3-0 lead. 40-yard drive, 8 plays, took just over 3 minutes. Chris snaps the field goal, and the Tigers out in front. They're trying to go 3-0 on the year. This is their first Southeastern Conference encounter. Chris Knapp will kick it away. Thomas Woods across the 20, gets to another man. Still on his feet and dives across the 30 to the 32-yard line. Thomas Woods, good agility and a nice return.
Thomas Woods also has a bit of a sore knee, so I don't know how long we're going to see him on the kickoff returns and the punt returns. The fastest man, and then I think would probably be the best receiver and punt returner, who's number 7, Anthony Miller.
Former All-American junior college player out of Pasadena City College. You watch him, number 7. This is Francis, the handoff to Howard. He is tripped up immediately. That is number 96, Benji Rowland, the big nose guard out of Eastman, Georgia, who makes the stop for Auburn. You know, Johnny Majors came in. He said, "I don't think we as a team have ever had a club in worse physical condition than this one." He's talking, of course, about Keith Davis, tailback we alluded to earlier. He's out with a banged-up knee. Charles Wilson, another running back, is hurting. Francis has been banged up as well. Howard breaks away, and he's first down. He added to the 43-yard line. That's some powerful running, then.
Some very strong running. You know what I like, Corey, about the fact that the fullback is switched to a tailback? When you're at the fullback, you have to make up your mind very quickly where the holes are opening up and so forth. It develops better eyes for reading the blocks very, very quickly. He comes down from his tailback position. He gets more time, but he's more definitive about where he wants to run.
Howard, 6 carries and 33 yards already. Francis, the ball is loose. He will recover himself on the 16-yard line. That was big number 92, Ron Stallward, who stripped the ball out of Francis's grasp, and a big loss for Tennessee, but they do have the football.
What a great play by Stallward. I was looking downfield, so looking at this replay will be the first time that I actually see this. This is a good move. Ball goes up in the air, he just reaches back, and the ball is fumbling around back there. Francis does a good job just to get back to it, but all in all, it ends up a minus 32-yard play.
The Tennessee's looking at a second and 36 here. Good shot of Ron Stallworth. He's gained some 30 pounds since enrolling here at Auburn. One of the strongest fellas on this team. Berger to throw, and a nice catch at the 25-yard line. That's Terrence Cleveland.
Terrence Cleveland did a good job of getting down as he was about to get hit. You'll see it here. Almost looks like he's going to get crunched between the two backers, but instead they more or less hit themselves. Good zone pass just in between coverage.
So it's 3rd and 27. They're going to kick it away.
A quick kick.
And Auburn's going to finally pick it up at about the 29-yard line, and back in there with Bob Garman, who kicked that ball away, a 46-yard kick. And you don't see that too often anymore. So the quick kick works well for Tennessee. Auburn's football on their own 29-yard line. The Tigers lead by 3.
The Auburn Tigers played in the 50th Sugar Bowl in 1984 and played in the 50th Cotton Bowl in 1986.
just under 4.5 minutes to go here in the first quarter at Jordan-Hare Stadium in Auburn, Alabama. The Tigers lead it by 3 as Johnny Majors very quickly slips in his punter, Bob Garman, on a third and long situation. The quick kick, and Auburn has the football on their own 29-yard line. Back to the eye. Berger, the handoff, Fullwood, still on his feet, still pulling away. Good second effort. Finally brought down the 35-yard line there by Terry Brown.
You see why he might be the best tailback for the Auburn Tigers. He hits this outside, and he is stopped basically at the line of scrimmage. And the rest, the game he gets out of this play, is just from his own powers, leg drive. Look, he never stops, steps over people, doesn't lose his balance, and even on a pretty clean shot like that one that brought him down, he still is up and driving.
Second and 4. Out of bounds at about the 37-yard line. Kelly Ziegler brought him across.
Corey, the story in this first quarter, with about 3 minutes and 47 seconds to go, might just be field position. The fact that Auburn has had it throughout the first quarter, and you see the ice there on the sideline, they're trying to keep everybody cool down in 93-plus weather.
Hey, we're hot enough out here, up here in the press box. Can you imagine what they're feeling down there? 93 degrees and that sunshine. 3rd and 2. Trying to cut it up, and he's going to be stopped short of the first down, I believe. And that's swarming all over the field Tennessee defense that coordinator Ken Donahue is so famous for comes up with a big third down play.
Speed is definitely the name of the game for Tennessee. They've got speed on the outside, on their offense, in the backfield. They've got great mobility and quickness on their defensive unit.
Brian Schulman is on. He transferred from Hull Places last year from Tennessee. Got a lot of buddies on his club, including Tennessee's quarterback, Jeff Francis. At Woods, he's got some room. 35, 40, look at him go. He's across midfield. He's got one man to beat. And he is stuck hard at about the 30-yard line as Woods just about sprung that one all the way back. The gain, 58 yards. Thomas Woods as Tom Powell, finally, the only man back there to wrap him up.
He gets off a good punt here. It's on the side. The best thing about the punt is that it's to the side of the blocking. Where the punt return was decided that they should return, and he gets a terrific block. When he first catches it, then finds nothing but room. But here, he doesn't become a runner. He becomes a fullback who's trying to run over someone.
Francis, handoff, Howard, he's got some room up to the 20-yard line, inside the 20. And suddenly, Tennessee is right there. Gary Kelly makes the stop for Auburn.
Once again, it's William, the tailback. Look at him, he takes the ball, runs like a fullback straight ahead. Now watch him how he protects the ball. He always protects that football when he gets into a crowd.
According to Auburn's Tracy Rocker, the offensive line for Tennessee is the best in the SEC. That's why William Howard can run his way through holes like that. He's got 44 yards already on 7 carries. You see they are just short of the first down. It's 2nd and 1. You know, last week, Howard ran, how many times was it? 34 carries, the third most carries in the history of Tennessee football behind Johnny Jones and Hubert Simpson. So he's on his way to a big-time day again, it appears. 2:40 to go here in the first quarter. 3-0 Auburn. Tennessee 2nd and 1 from the Auburn 20-yard line. Howard just crashes his way forward for the first down, I believe. Yes, it is. First down, Tennessee.
Keith Davis is going to have to come back and do a lot of work to take the tailback job away.
Francis looks over the defense. He's going to give it to Howard. Loose ball. I believe Auburn's got it. And they do at the 20-yard line. Francis and Howard fail to connect. Auburn's football. Number 93 is Andre Bruce. Came up with a football. Here we see it, Lynn. Howard.
Howard seems to have the football here, but right there, looks like Bruce. It's Bruce. He'll stick his hand in there and knocks it away. In the first two ball games, Tennessee did not have a single turnover. But here in a game with 2 minutes left to play in the quarter, they turn it over, taking away a scoring threat.
Well, Johnny Majors can't be terribly pleased about that turnover, but at the same time, he's been a long time since he's seen a running back fumble a football.
He certainly has. Matter of fact, his running backs have not fumbled a football for several games, including the Sugar Bowl and all the carries they had there.
Forward. Harris blocking. Turns the corner. 30-yard line. Knocked out there by Terry Brown. Big Brent Fullwood, the leading rusher on this football team. Michigan defeating Florida State today. Pittsburgh, big over West Virginia. As we take a look at some of the finals around the country today, Clemson easily over Georgia Tech.
Good to see someone winning in Pittsburgh.
Ole Miss victorious today. Second one, 9-yard pickup by Fullwood. College Campbell now in the game, number 38. But to give that time, the first man through, Vincent Harris, who's up to about the 34-yard line. Good for the first down. Look at Northwestern today, winning big. Late first quarter. The Tigers, a 3-0 lead.
But there was number 54, excuse me, Dale Jones, who got in there, made the first contact, good pursuit, forced him to stay deep in his own territory, then let Charles Kendrell come up and make the final stop.
.103 to go, first quarter, as Berger comes up to the line, facing a second and 13. Tim Jesse, close to the 40, but he's still 3 yards short of the first down. Now let's throw it down to Mike Adamly on the sideline.
Corey, one of the quickest way to get underneath a diehard Auburn football fan's skin is to call the school by the wrong nickname. Now, there's a lot of confusion here, and we're going to set the record straight. Now, which is it? The marketing department's partly to blame. Is it the Tigers, or is it the War Eagles? Well, to set this record straight, the official nickname is the Tigers. The official battle cry is War Eagles.
Third and three. Berger going to hang it out. I think he just threw it away there. Nobody was around.
He certainly did. When we sat and talked with Pat Sullivan yesterday about Berger and his progression as a quarterback, he said one of the things he's doing good now is not making the mistakes. Here he wants to throw the quick screen, but he sees there's someone right there to pick it up, so instead of turning it over or going for getting a loss, he throws it away.
Chauvin on the kick again. This time he's going to make sure Woods doesn't get much of a head start, and here he is back on a 15. Oh, is he hit? That is number 48 for Auburn, Alvin Mitchell. What a hit.
What a hit. What an arm. He must be in the weight room just doing those one-handed curls, because that's all he gets is his one arm right under the collar. Looks like, good thing he didn't grab onto that face mask, or else he'd be looking for his head.
6 feet, 225 pounder out of Venice, Florida. And watch the right arm here.
Oh, boy.
Oh.
He is real lucky.
That's got to hurt. Remember now, Woods is only 5'10", 160 pounds, so... Running down in a heap there.
Right,
final second, first quarter, Tennessee on the 12.
He's only 5 feet tall right now.
Yeah, I think he lost a few inches. Howard pulling his way to the 17-yard line.
Very interesting, Corey. Tennessee just pulling its way through the center of the line. Auburn doing as much as they can to fight them, but Tennessee is having a great deal of success. We're at the end of the first quarter, Auburn ahead.
The name is Nissan.
First quarter stats, it's all Auburn. Those stats somewhat misleading because it includes that big 32-yard loss when Francis had the ball stripped midway in the first half. We begin the second quarter, and Francis wants to put it up. He's going long, and it is caught. Is it caught? Unbelievable. Klingscale, Joey Klingscale, his favorite catch is over the shoulder. I think that was deflected into his arms. That's a remarkable grab.
Well, here's some great anticipation by Francis, because Joey Klingscale is covered all the way. Right here, the ball just goes through the defender's hand, and that is pure concentration on Joey Klingscale's part. Take a look, another look at it here on an isolated view. Just watch the ball slip through the defender's hand. And he's being buffed. Joey Klingscale is being bucked and still comes up with the grab.
48-yard connection. Howard tries to go around. Oh, he is hit. Number 40, Arthur Johnson takes him down. I'll tell you what, Klingscale has had to serve in the shadows, I think, of some outstanding players. Last year it was Tim McGee, with Willie Gault a few years ago, and this year he feels this may be his opportunity to shine. And outstanding player out of Knoxville, Tennessee.
He's a tough ball player. He's got very deceptive speed, Corey. He doesn't look like he's moving that fast. He probably is only about a 4.6. And that's not bad speed, but it's not superior speed.
1 yard loss. It's second and 11. Francis, safety valve. Howard to the 30. Where he's brought down by Phillips. We talked a lot about Berger and his success throwing the ball. Francis passed for 230 yards in their first game of the year against New Mexico.
Certainly did. I think that was a quick screen for you. He had Big John Galbraith out there in front of him, so it was more by design. Half the time, you can't tell. Those linemen sometimes get caught up on the inside. They don't make it to the outside. But there, he really didn't pick up a great deal of yardage on the play.
Third and three. Miller and Howard to give Howard, and he is stacked up. Phillips is in there again. I believe he is short by about a yard of the first down.
Someone's down on the field. I can't see who it is.
Looks like number 57 for Tennessee, which is Darryl Smith, the offensive tackle out of Knoxville.
That's exactly who it is. Once again, Tennessee has been plagued by injuries in the first two games. Now another one in the third.
Well, they have. Johnny Majors got to be wondering about his condition. Next week, the undefeated Alabama Crimson Tide will entertain Lou Holtz and the Fighting Irish of Notre Dame. You know, Alabama, he might just be as good as anybody.
They're very, very strong. You know, Perkins came in there and had his problems building the program, trying to adjust from the professional ranks where he was the coach of the New York Giants. Took him a couple years. He adjusted.
And right now, wow, Notre Dame leads Purdue 10-0 going after their first victory of the year.
Lou Holtz, you think it's just a matter of time. Had some close ball games earlier.
Well, if you saw him playing that opener against Michigan, you got a flavor of the kind of results he can get and get in a hurry. The way that club played, they really should have won that ball game.
They really should have. They just didn't penetrate and get the points when they're down the scoring territory. They had the opportunities, and they maybe just tightened up a bit. The pressure got on them, whatever. They didn't win the ball game.
Hey, you talk about backs and great ones. Andrews, Brooks, and Cribbs, who actually played together at the same time in the late 70s right here at Auburn. Lionel James came just right after that. Of course, Bo Jackson. Wow.
You look at William Andrews and Bo Jackson. Of course, Bo Jackson decided not to play football. Outstanding people in terms of just running the football, as you see Smith being taken off. But those other three guys, three of the best multi-purpose backs in the entire National Football League. They do everything for you.
And the group of backs they have here at Auburn today as a group, probably the best since that Cribbs, Brooks, and Andrews group back in the late 70s here at Auburn. LeVays will try a 36, make it a 46-yard field goal for Tennessee. He's got the leg for it. I don't know if it's going to make it this time. It does not. It is short and a wide right. So LeVays fails on a 46-yard field goal effort as Tennessee attempted to tie this ball game up. The Tigers still lead. We're early in the second.
goes shot for shot with a formidable opponent. Find out what you're made of. That's the communications game MCI plays every day. MCI competes by investing over $1 billion a year to keep our network the industry's most modern. We know our competition's good. We have to be better. And because we compete, you win. MCI. Communications for the next 100 years.
It's time you said, bye-bye, basics.
Hello, Sentra.
The all-new Nissan Sentra 487 is much more than basic transportation. It's newly designed with a longer wheelbase, smoother ride, and superior handling. So say, bye-bye, basics.
Hello, Sentra.
Who made their most affordable car even better? The name is Nissan, America's number one selling import car.
A network television premiere. Raiders of the Lost Ark. Join the adventure Sunday.
Updates of two significant scores. Miami and Oklahoma so far a scoreless battle between number one and number two. OU sacked Vinny Testaverde on the first play from scrimmage, and that has set the tone. Meanwhile, they have entered the fourth quarter in Boulder, where Colorado attempts to upset Arizona for a second consecutive year. The winless Buffaloes still leading the top 10 Wildcats, 21-15, about 13 minutes to go. Corey McFerrin.
Thank you, Jim Lampley. The post-Bo Jackson era going just fine so far for the Tigers. Coming in at 2-0, trying to make it 3-0. In fact, we talked to several of the players about that, about what it's like to face this season without Bo Jackson. And that is Tim Jesse, who powers for about 3 yards. And most of them told us that, hey, we relied so much on Bo last year. Ben Tamborello told us that, hey, we think like we're going to be a better team because everybody realizes they have to do that much more, rely on everybody, not one guy, to get us out of tough situations. He says that's the difference this year. Flag on the play.
Holding against Auburn. I believe that, Corey, but I also believe that when you have a great talent on your football team, he is going to make everyone else better around him. They're going to look better because of his great talent, but he is also going to inspire that person to perform at their maximum level.
Offense, the 3 first down.
I say that from experience. I mean, look, sure, back at the Pittsburgh Steelers, John Stallworth and I, for many years, he and I competed internally, trying to be the best, you know, always wanting to catch more passes, to make the tough catch, only in effort to be better.
12:35 to go here in the second quarter. Auburn a 3-point lead. Berger the handoff to A.G., and A.G. is hit the 25-yard line, brought down to 26 by Milton Gordon, reserve linebacker out of Jacksonville, Florida.
Now, we are still early in this ball game with just over 12 minutes to play in the second quarter. Well, I'm surprised that so far it's been such a defensive battle.
Well, one thing the Auburn players told us, especially some of the linemen, is that, hey, the way Tennessee moves around on that line, the stunts and switches they pull, it's awful hard to detect. As Berger throws it out of bounds and running over there to cover on the play, it was intended for Tommy Agee. Number 13, David Poole, who spilled over the sidelines there.
That's one way to get in communication.
Yeah, no kidding. One way to break a leg, too.
Again, we're looking at great pressure by the Tennessee defense, and you know, Jeff is the kind of quarterback, and this is the kind of offense a defense likes to play against. He doesn't move around a great deal in that pocket, much like Vinny Testaverde down in Miami when they played against him in the Sugar Bowl. He stayed in that pocket. They were able to get the pressure and bring him down.
Berger with only one complete pass so far today. Third and 14. Great drop back here. Look out. Dumps it off. It is nothing. They're about the 21-yard line. That ball went out to Walter Reeves, the tight end, Milton Gordon there for Tennessee. Auburn having a tough time moving the ball.
Milton Gordon is a right inside linebacker, and Tennessee just did a terrific job of putting pressure on the quarterback and then defending that quick screen. That's a tough play to defense, too.
So Shulman, his fourth punt of the afternoon. It's a boomer to the 28. Thomas Wood drops it. Look out. Here come the Tigers. He has pummeled at about the 24-yard line. So Tennessee will take over again. Shan Morris
give him credit for that tackle. Tigers are up by a field goal. This SEC matchup, obviously extraordinarily important for both clubs, but even more so for Tennessee since they lost once already to Mississippi State 2 weeks ago, 27-23. Johnny Majors came in and said, hey, if we lose, we are totally out of the race. They realize that there's never been a club to lose twice in the SEC conference schedule and then go on to win the title. They have to win today. Auburn on offense from the 40-yard line, and that is Tim Jesse. Stacked up at about the 46-yard line. David Poole is there. A few other scores for you around the country.
And of course, for the Auburn football team, Pat Dye has said this team this year has not been challenged, has not been tested. They had two easy football games, if you will, more like preseason football games until this game this afternoon. So there's a lot of questions he wants to get answered here.
They beat UT Chattanooga, and then they beat East Carolina. Scores 42-14 and 45-0. Berger firing, almost picked off, and as Walter Reeves, a big tight end. I'm sorry, that's Lawyer Tillman, number 85, who made the catch on the far side.
No, Pat Sullivan told us he was going to throw this pass. I asked him, said, is Jeff strong enough? Is his arm strong enough to get it out there? This is why I asked the question. That is one of the toughest passes to complete in football. The ball's got to be a rocket to the outside because the cornerback, if he reads it, has a great angle to pick it off. And if he does, there's no one in front of him to stop him from running it back for a touchdown.
Third and two. Handoff, the big guy, Reggie Ware, the designated runner from short distances across midfield. For the first down yardage, Reggie Ware stands 6'2", 243 pounds. Former Parade High School All-American, and I think I'd give it to a guy who weighs 245 in that situation.
You betcha.
Run right through a wall. So first down Tigers. You got 9 minutes to go here and a half. Auburn up, 3-0. Play action. Berger wants to toss it. Looking for A.G., I believe. So far, Berger having very little success.
That's Brian Kinbrough on the sideline. Looks like they're working on his hand.
Kinbrough starting outside linebacker. There's Pat Dye hunting for his 99th career victory today.
We got somewhat of a victory last night as Auburn has decided to build a new multi-million-dollar sports facility here.
Berger, that's complete, and that is Walter Reeves, the tight end over the middle, inside the 30, to this 27-yard line, and Reeves coming in, only caught two balls all year long.
And that time, it's just a quick pass. The tight end just comes off the line of scrimmage, runs straight down the field against what appears to be man-to-man coverage. Nobody there in the center of the football field, so he picks it up for a strong 21-yard gain.
Auburn with the ball at 27-yard line. Berger wants to put it up again. He's got a man at Bolton at the 5-yard line. Scott Bolton, Auburn, 5 yards away from Pater.
Tennessee looks like they're in a blitz, but they don't come with a blitz. Still, they're in man-to-man coverage. He sent one receiver down the middle of the field on a post, the other on a flag route. The post was covered, but Scott Bolton was open deep and on the sideline for the big yard, for the big game.
Berger to Bolton, 22 yards. Ball just outside the 5-yard line. Reggie Ware in the backfield, but it's the pitch. The 1-yard line. Knocked out by Peppers and Brown, along with Darren Miller, and Fullwood just about got in.
Now Fullwood going for the corner, trying to stretch it out. But Peppers, number 8, has enough speed to meet him there. He gets there. No, that wasn't Peppers. Peppers is coming over late.
Trying to help out.
Trying to help out.
All right, second goal. That's where. Touchdown, Auburn! number 36, Reggie Ware, gives Auburn a 9-point lead. That's his third touchdown of the season. Wouldn't want to have to stop that fella, 243 pounds. Extra point, Chris Knapp. It's good.
Well, if you can call a football team cool when the temperature is at 91 degrees, then we can say it about the Auburn Tigers, because they have just coolly and calmly moved their way down the field, running the football up the middle, not making a mistake, going in for the first touchdown, and they take a 10-0 lead in the second quarter.
Both mean something great to these guys. Mount Hood means the best summer skiing in America. And Old Milwaukee means a great beer. Cold, crisp Old Milwaukee beer. And smooth, golden Old Milwaukee light.
There's nothing like the flavor of a special place. An Old Milwaukee beer.
Old Milwaukee and Old Milwaukee light.
Man, it doesn't get any better than this.
If you don't hurry, I'll miss my plane.
Well, I'm doing the best I can in this terrible rain.
Would a new set of Anko wiper blades help?
Certainly. Put them on.
Change to Anko, the best-selling brand of wiper blades and refills.
There, now I can see an airplane. Airplane! Oh!
Don't worry, Ollie. It wasn't mine. That's mine.
Oh! Anko, the best blades you can buy. Test proven.
A classic football matchup. The Fighting Irish of Notre Dame tackle undefeated and third-ranked Alabama. Coverage begins with College Football Today next Saturday.
Back at Jordan-Hare Stadium, 72,000 strong. Most of them very happy right now as Auburn has assumed a 10-0 lead. Just over 8 minutes to go. Chris Knapp kicking off for the Tigers. Thomas Woods bobbles the ball, 2-yard line. Look out now. A little jitter step. And finally works his way up across the 15-yard line. Second time in a row, Woods has had a tough time grabbing hold of that football.
Well, when you let that football hit you in the chest, it just hits the hard plastic of your shoulder pads and bounces away from you. It's hard to catch it when it ricochets so quickly off your chest.
Oftentimes, though, you see the defense, the kickoff team, come down, overplay that, and the guy gets a little bit of a break and scoots out. Sometimes works real well.
Almost did that time.
8:02 to go. Handoff. Howard. Few yard gain. Don't forget now, beginning Tuesday night, October the 7th. Major League Baseball playoff action begins. The American League Championship Series will begin on the 7th. The National League opens up on the 8th. And obviously, the way the baseball season has gone this year, no pennant races. We know who they are. Angels, Red Sox, along with the Mets and the Astros. Howard booming across midfield. Not midfield, middle of the line. Excuse me. Kurt Crane is there. Kurt Crane, inside linebacker, interesting story. Here's a fellow who transferred to Auburn from Memphis State. He's leading the club in tackles. William Howard. First and 10. Howard, a lot of room. Up to the 40-yard line. Lots of space on the right side that time.
I was about to say, they ought to give him a nickname like Freight Train. But with that deep voice of his friends call him DJ for disc jockey. He's got one of those deep, resonant voices that just carries a mile.
Howard already with 59 yards on 14 carries. First down again for Tennessee, ball to 39-yard line. Charles Wilson in the ball game. But to give it to Howard, his 15th carry of the day, and he may be out to break that all-time career carry record for Tennessee today. Nate Hill is there to make the stop for Auburn. William Howard just doesn't seem to get tired, does he?
Well, I asked him about his conditioning. Now, at fullback, he wasn't carrying the ball much. He comes back to play tailback. Says every day at practice, he carries that ball on each play 40 yards down the field. So he's in the best shape he's ever been in his life, and he should be good enough to carry him through this ballgame.
Second and four, Tennessee keeping the football on the ground. Timeout.
25-second clock, the time they have to call a play and get it off, was down to 3 seconds, so that was a wise call on his part.
Wise play by Francis. 5 minutes, 54 seconds to go. Francis and Johnny Majors talk it up. Behind the strong running of William Howard, Tennessee is moving the football, trying to get it across midfield. As you see, the scoring summary, nap the field goal. Reggie Ware capping a long Auburn drive with a one-yard touchdown plunge. The Tigers, 10-0 leaders, less than 6 minutes to go here at Jordan-Hare Stadium. And that is Howard again, close to midfield, his 16th carry of the afternoon.
Off the offensive Tennessee, settling in to a ground attack, just really going after the interior defensive line of the Auburn Tigers. Somewhat surprising, since when I look at their offensive unit and the great receivers they have on this football team, it seems like Tennessee is more of an offensive clinic for wide receivers.
Joey Klingscale showed us his talent a little earlier with that fabulous catch. Another fellow to watch, Anthony Miller, who has yet to show himself today. No passes in his direction. We should see him before it's over. Right now, though, Johnny Majors is trying to pound the ball down Auburn's throat.
One thing I have to ask myself, based on the way they're playing their offense right now, is whether or not Jeff Francis' shoulder is completely healed. Maybe he's just trying to save him as much as possible.
Francis hurt that shoulder, the first shoulder injury he's ever suffered, in the first series of the game against Mississippi State 2 weeks ago. Randy Sanders came in for him a little bit later on, and Francis was doubtful earlier in the week. That's Miller in motion right there, number seven. Berger going up. Let's see if he's got an arm, and he does, but it might be picked off. Overthrown. Again, it was intended for Miller, the man covering Tom Powell, the All-SEC free safety. And Miller never really had a chance for that ball.
Well, Miller didn't have a chance. There was nothing really on that pass either. I mean, that's a long pass. He had to put that one in the air, close to 50 yards. But you see, he gets it up in the air. Miller's just double covered. The squeeze is put on. He doesn't have a chance to use his speed to go after the ball.
I'll tell you what, if he put more on it, it would have been an Auburn interception. Fourth and one, and Tennessee is going for it. Be willing to bet it's going to go to the second man through William Howard. Auburn knows the same thing. The pitch. Oh, a great defensive play. Auburn's Sean Morris comes in from his strong safety slot. Tackle behind the line of scrimmage. Auburn knew what was coming. Great defensive effort.
Well, that's one of those chalkboard plays where you look at film and you decide on what you want to do in this situation. We don't see it here, but the defensive line just taking on people, creating the opening, and right there, Sean just comes through for the biggest play defensively of this ballgame.
John Morris, whose father, Larry Morris, played for the Chicago Bears back in the 60s. I'm sure his dad is beaming wherever he is today. First and 10, 45-yard line. Berger wants it all. It's up top, and it's incomplete. That ball intended for the Flyer. His name,
Alexander Wright.
His 40 time, what is it, 4-2?
4.2 seconds. And they said when he comes into the ball game, look for a deep.
Ooh.
And Pat Dye was a man of his word. They put him in the ball game. He streaked down the sideline. It was a tough catch, but he had a chance to make it.
He's only made one catch all year. That was for 33 yards against East Carolina, but he is the fastest man on the team, and that's the only kind of a throw that probably is going to head in his direction. Berger, as you see, was 61 yards on the day. We've got 5:03 to go. A little confusion. Berger will jump on the football. Exactly what he should do. Jesse and Berger, a mix-up in the backfield. Berger does the white wise thing, just falls on the ball.
Well, it looks like he's trying to do some kind of like cross action there. But you can't blame the quarterback. You can't blame the tailback. You blame both of them in a situation like that. I don't know who made the mistake.
a wasted play for the Tigers. They face a third down and 14 situation. Jesse in the slot, A.G. the single. Set back, look out. Berger is tackled behind the line. That is Mark Hovenak, who is the big man on this, the big play man for Tennessee. He had four big plays coming in. That is his second sack of the year.
Had a little help from number 74, Brian Hunt. As Brian and Mark just team up on the blitz here. Brian Hunt makes him duck. Mark lays him out.
Hovenak led Tennessee last year with eight quarterback sacks and a shank punt this time by Brian Schulman. And Tennessee will get the ball back at about the 43-yard line. Now let's visit the UT campus.
The University of Tennessee, a place where learning can move in as many directions as you care to take, in a form clearly aimed at seeking new choices, that examines new definitions and gives shape to your personal future. Whether you see yourself in the sciences or the arts, at Tennessee, we want to put you in touch with the special view you hold. This is Tennessee, a place where you can shape your future.
Francis, you just came back in time to see the incomplete pass intended for fullback Jim Miller. That punt by Schulman, only 17 yards. Came in leading the SEC, I should say second in the SEC, with an average just under 46 yards a punt. With Tennessee facing the second and 10 now after the incomplete pass by Francis. They're on their own 42-yard line. We've got 3 minutes and 47 seconds to go. They trail Auburn by 10 points. It's 10-0. Keith Panuska.
Big flag thrown out in the field.
Panuska's first carry of the afternoon. Good for a couple of yards. We'll try to figure out what this penalty is all about.
See the size of that flag he just threw out there?
It's like a picnic blanket.
It does. I mean, if they painted red, white, and blue, we'd have to hoist it up in the air.
Holding against Tennessee. That'll back them up to about the, let's see, 32-yard line.
Holding, offense, 10 yards.
So sets up a second and 20 for the ball. Francis fakes the little pass to the halfback left side. He goes to Howard, and he is crushed. Number 42, Gary Kelly.
Gary Kelly just slipped through the blocking in the screen. Coaches always tell offensive linemen, when you set up for the screen, you have a specific assignment. But there's a rule to govern any mistake, which is don't let anybody through. Hit the first man, even if he's not your man. Nobody hit him. And he just came through, and it looked like he was bulldogging the running back.
Third down, 18. Francis, your quarterback. He wants to fire. Good protection. Dumps it out to Howard, who drops the football. Of course, the dead ball immediately.
Howard just turned away from that pass much too soon. Not staying with it. Big defensive stand for the Auburn Tigers.
Tigers D coming through.
Just have to say that the offensive, the coach for the Tennessee football team and punters is a guy named Craig Colquitt, who punted for the Pittsburgh Steelers for many, many years.
Yarman booms it. Gaines gets back the other way up to the 25-yard line. Now let's take time to visit the Auburn campus here in Auburn, Alabama. Tommy Agee. Short run for about 2 yards up the middle. Auburn's first play from scrimmage on this drive. 2 minutes and 10 seconds to go here in the first half. Ball on the 27-yard line. to be able to throw the ball when he had to. He's done that today. We're not looking at the BYU, the Southeastern Conference, but it is a throwing attack that they haven't had here in a long time.
Brett Forward, good breaker. Look at him go. He's brought down the 45-yard line. He's mad at himself. He had one man to beat. He might have gone all the way.
Boy, you see the quick acceleration this gentleman has. Gets to a hole and bang, he is gone.
I think that was Mark Havoc who comes through, has a chance to make the tackle right there, doesn't, and then he just takes off. Brent Fullwood, number 22, found the opening and turned on the Jets.
I think it was Terry McDaniel that saved Tennessee from a long, long touchdown. As it is, it's a 20-yard gain. Fullwood, six carries, 49 yards. Berger to throw, steps up in the pocket. It is incomplete. Lawyer Tillman got a hand on it about the 37-yard line, could not pull it in. So the clock stops with a minute and 23 to go in the first half.
Lawyer did a very good job of coming back at an angle to try and make that catch. The Tennessee defensive back, Peppers, was drifting back as if the ball was intended for him as a receiver. Had his arms outstretched like he was going to make a catch on the sideline, and Tillman just came through, made an effort for it.
Auburn's defense so far, had a look at him there on the sideline, holding Tennessee scoreless. Volunteers unable to get on the board yet. Auburn trying to get on the board again here before the first half ends. That's Collis Campbell, driven out of bounds at about the 45-yard line.
Ziegler was a man who came in and made the stop. Kelly Ziegler, the inside linebacker. And on that play, he lined up like he was in the starting blocks for a race, Corey. You could read that was a blitz coming all the way.
Now, Campbell is one of two running backs that Pat Dye and his coaches decided to redshirt last year, with Bo Jackson being the centerpiece. They didn't feel like Jesse and Campbell would get much playing time. Let's save them for next year. They agreed to it. They're getting a chance to play this year a lot more than they ever would have last year.
Now, they probably were in favor of that move, and if coach didn't make that decision, they probably would have knocked them through the next day and asked them to do it.
Yeah, exactly. There's Berger on the sidelines talking to Pat Dye. Nice haircut. Had the crew cut done along with about 25 other teammates last week. Again, next week, Notre Dame and Alabama from Birmingham. Alabama, as you know, undefeated. They are off this week. Notre Dame, last report, leading Michigan State, or leading Purdue, I'm sorry, by a 17-0 margin. The Irish and the Crimson Tide.
Notre Dame beats Purdue today. Then they've got that winning feeling. They come up against a team like Alabama, ranked very high, a strong football team. They can make their whole season. Maybe they won't be a national championship team, but they could be a team that knocks off teams. And Notre Dame has scored again. They lead 24-0, I think I was told.
24-0. So the Irish getting primed for the Crimson Tide at Legion Field next Saturday. Don't forget, coming up just a couple minutes, all the scores on the Prudential Report. Highlights as well from games across America. A minute 18 to go. Auburn, a 10-0 lead. It's third and 11 for the Tigers. Berger almost intercepted. It should have been. That's Terry Brown at about the 40-yard line. That ball intended for Bolton across the middle.
There was a blitz all the way. Offensive line of Auburn does a good job of picking it up. He's got his man downfield. He has to thread the needle, but he throws it just behind him. If he had thrown that perfectly, it would have been picked off by someone else coming across.
Schulman shanked one last time. Fair catch. Andre Kramer. 37 yards on the kick by Schulman. So Tennessee has a minute and 5 seconds to see if they can't get something rolling, and I wouldn't think that Johnny Majors would do anything other than something conservative here this last minute and 5 seconds.
I'm not so sure. Last time I said that, I was
went
wrong.
The other way, didn't it? Don't forget, Monday night, we got the Cowboys and the Cardinals from St. Louis.
I'm looking forward to when they put Herschel Walker in at fullback with Tony Dorsett, and they just play that tandem all the time.
Don't you think eventually it's going to head that way?
I think it will.
William Howard, a couple of yards, not much. John Stallworth is in there, along with Tracy Rocker. That's fun to say, Tracy Rocker. Rocker. The Tigers of Auburn. 93 degrees here at Auburn. 72,000 looking on. This little town comes alive on Football Saturday, we'll tell you. Simple handoff again to Howard. He's not going anywhere, as we thought. Coach Mazur's just going to run out the clock here with a couple of basic plays to end the first half. Volunteers had defeated New Mexico in game one. They lost to Mississippi State in game two. They averaged 22 points in those ball games. So far today, nothing to show at all on the board. It's Auburn 10, Tennessee nothing. We'll have more from Auburn in a moment. Halftime entertainment continues at Jordan-Hare Stadium, Auburn, Alabama. Take a look now at the halftime statistics. Sometimes called the halftime stats, right, Lynn?
Yeah, that's correct.
As we see the rushing yardage, Auburn way out front. Passing yardage, very close. Total yardage, Auburn with an advantage. And time of possession, very close, too. But as we mentioned, Auburn came up with the big plays when they had to make them.
And Tennessee is only down by 10 points. Everything else is very, with the exception of the yardage there and the rushing, is very, very close. The turnover there by Tennessee, not a good column to have big numbers in. But I think we're going to see Tennessee come back out after the second half and try and put the ball in the air a great deal more. They have to catch up, and I just don't believe they're going to be able to do it consistently on the ground.
Question mark is Jeff Francis. Is his shoulder in the kind of condition to allow him to throw the ball effectively? They certainly have the wide receivers who are capable of pulling the ball down.
They've got great receivers with wonderful speed. I saw them practice on Wednesday, and I think this kid, Anthony Miller, is going to be a fine pro prospect someday, a great player. But they're not putting the ball in the air. They're not finding them on the short routes and medium routes. And again, I have to question whether Francis' shoulder is completely healed and he can get the ball out there.
I think, too, for those of our viewers who are seeing Tennessee perhaps for the first time this year, they notice the drop-off, the difference in the quarterback situation. Without a Darryl Dickey or a Tony Robinson they've been used to seeing last year when they won the SEC title, won the Sugar Bowl. They really miss that kind of leadership out there, that kind of talent, as we see the temperature at 100 degrees on the field.
Ouch. And, of course, that's going to have probably the most dramatic effect on the Tennessee players, because they've got so many players that have been injured. They've got backup people playing different positions. If they get other people hurt this afternoon, they won't be game ready. Therefore, the heat's going to have a greater effect on them.
That's right. Guys like Robbie Scott at nose guard, Richard Cooper, defensive tackle, Charles Davis, Keith Davis, they're all out. Auburn leads at halftime, 10-0. We're back at beautiful Jordan-Hare Stadium, named for Chuck Jordan, of course. Auburn's winning his coach, 176 victories, and Dean Cliff-Hare, who played in Auburn's very first football team and served as faculty athletic chairman for a long, long time. Some 72,000 seats here, and you see some of the construction underway on the far side, putting up a whole new upper deck that will expand the capacity here to more than 85,000 and will include some 69 of those palatial sky boxes, the kind of places Lynn Swann likes to watch his football from, right?
Well, if I'm going to watch a football game these days and I'm not going to work like today, yes, I'd like to be in the palatial sky box. Maybe something like Georgia Frontier's two-story box over at Anaheim Stadium, one of those owned by U.S. Steel or Heinz Corporation in Pittsburgh.
Sure, one of those big corporate types. But this should be ready for next year, as I understand it.
$15 million,
isn't it? $15 million project.
$15 million project. 13,000 new seats. And if you didn't think college football was big time business, well, you're mistaken. They need those extra seats here. I think there's a move here in Auburn also to have many of the games they play, especially the one against Alabama, to be a home and away situation and bring that game down here.
to get a definite home field advantage when they play the Crimson Tide, unquestionably their chief rival. That was Jeff Berger, quarterback for Auburn, who really excited about this year, a chance to get out there, throw the ball. He is the man, the number one quarterback for the Tigers this year. Last year he was caught in a situation, they had three different guys all trying to angle their way towards that top spot. This year they said, Jeff, the job is yours, we're going to throw the ball. They brought in a quarterback coach, the Heisman Trophy winner, Pat Sullivan, and so far everything is peachy for Berger and the Tigers. Right now it's Chris Knapp going to kick it off for Auburn, back to receive at the goal line. That is Anthony Miller, number seven. 10-0 Auburn as we begin the second half from Auburn, Alabama. Short kick falls out of bounds at about the 23-yard line.
Thomas Woods, number five, had been back there returning them and also returning punts. He had a problem fumbling one in the first half. He was replaced at the last punting return situation. And, of course, I told you that he did have a little problem with the knee prior to this ball game. Now we see the speedster, number seven, Anthony Miller, back returning kickoffs.
So we will try it once again. The 38th meeting between Tennessee and Auburn. It all began November 10th, 1900.
What were you doing then?
What were my grandparents doing? I'm not sure they were around.
Go Hendrick!
Auburn, by the way, won that game 23-0. Jeff Francis out of Mount Prospect, Illinois. They banged up his shoulder 2 weeks ago. Here's a swift kick by Knapp, bounding around the 35-yard line. Man with the football is, looks like Jim Miller. Just got a score in on that Miami-Oklahoma game, and all college football fans are interested in. Miami leads it 7-3.
At the end of the first half, and that's surprising. Oklahoma having scored so many points in its previous two ball games, being held scoreless in the first half.
Well, we saw him 3 weeks ago today, and I have a hard time believing anybody can keep him to 3 points and a half. As we begin the second half, the ball with William Howard picking up just where he left off at the end of the first half, right up the gut. And Randy Sanders is your quarterback. Randy Sanders coming in replacing Jeff Francis here on the first series of the second half. Sanders came in replacing Francis in the football game 2 weeks ago against Mississippi State. He completed 10 of 14 passes that day, a 71% completion rate, no interceptions, no touchdowns, as long as 33 yards. Sanders at quarterback for Tennessee. And Johnny Major told me last night he planned to use Sanders, just didn't know where or when. Pass intended for Anthony Miller, a wobbly pass, and Sanders off to somewhat of a shaky start off that pass.
Well, he had number 42, Gary Kelly, linebacker, who came in and really got in his face, threw his hands up on that quick screen. They teach the linemen on that quick screen play to the outside to cut the defensive linemen so they can't get their hands up. He came in clear, got hands and body up for a play which Tennessee likes to run quite a bit.
Third down conversions, as you see. Nothing so far. Here's our first opportunity of the second half. Third and nine. Ball on the 41-yard line. Sanders calling signals. He's going to put it up. He's going to run. He's going to be smothered. Benji Rowland, along with Russ Carricker, number 47 right there, stops Sanders and the Volunteers. And Tennessee's first series on offense goes nowhere. Trey Gaines back to receive for Auburn. Bob Garman in the punt once again. Sanders does not have quite the arm that Francis has. That is when Francis is healthy. Gaines inside the 15 on the far sideline, near sideline, 25-yard line. Trey Gaines holds the record for career punt returns at Auburn. He's been doing it since his freshman season.
Coach says he's a Howard Twilley type of receiver. Very precise, not the great speed, but the good hand, reliable, make the tough catch for you. Good field vision, smart player. Number 12 is your quarterback for Auburn, Jeff Berger.
Backs in the eye, you've got A.G. and Brent Fullwood. Pitch, Fullwood, cuts outside, and he is hammered at the 30-yard line. Victor Peppers is there along with Andre Creamer.
He ran that
and
one.
Terry Brown.
He ran that one very strong yesterday at the short practice they had. Just kind of walked through special teams. He was on the practice field with sandals on. And he wasn't trying to be super cool or casual about anything, but he had a couple, he had a blister between his toes. And it just agitated him. So he just had the sandals up there. Wouldn't agitate them too much prior to the game.
Second and five. Forward again. Still on his feet. Still struggling. And I think he made the first down yardage for Auburn.
Forward progress is enough for the first down. Take a look from our end zone camera. Look at the offensive line. They push that. They push everybody down to the right there of the screen. Big hole for them right there. Wait for the secondary to come up to make the stop. Little Peppers hauling them down. Small but mighty.
Forward averaging more than 7 yards a carry so far this afternoon. 8 carries, 59 yards. And there he is again. Slashing across the right side for a couple more yards for Auburn. Forward suffered a groin pull early last week. Kind of hampered him a little bit. But looks to be full speed today. Led this Auburn team in a rushing in 84. That was the year Bo Jackson went down early with the injury. Last year was the number two rusher on this football team. That's Tommy Agee. Short of the first down by a couple yards. Here's a guy, real popular on this Auburn football team. One of the friendliest fellas out there. Totally unselfish player. And truly one of the big reasons why Bo Jackson was able to run for the kind of yardage he was able to compile the last 4 years here at Auburn. Tremendous blocker. Getting a chance to do more than block this year for Auburn. The third and four play. Berger, short pass. Batted up in the air. That was Brian Hunt. Good defensive effort by Hunt as Berger's pass is batted down. And Auburn will have to punt the ball away.
You can see the results of spending some extra time with the linemen, getting them to put their hands up in the air once the quarterback has committed himself to passing.
Bounding down to about the 12-yard line, and as Andre Creamer gets up to about the 14-yard line, long kick, 46 yards. Turn of two, Tennessee on offense. We come back for a first-round draft selection, talking about number 87, Joey Klingscale. Split in out of Knoxville. He's a senior. Averaged nearly 20 yards a catch last year to lead this club. That's William Howard. Today, by the way, Klingscale's just one reception. That was a magnificent one for 48 yards in the first half.
And Klingscale's only having the one catch is not because he hasn't been out there running pass routes. It's because they just haven't thrown the ball that much. William Howard's been running the ball well. And again, I'm speculating. I just don't believe Jeff Francis' shoulder has healed.
Again, Randy Sanders, second series of the second half, is again a quarterback, shouting instructions to his wideouts. But it's a simple handoff, fumble. And Auburn recovers. Ron Stallwood grabs it after Tracy Rocker strips the ball away. Stallwood, big defensive play. He and Rocker team up. Tigers football, watch it again.
And for a football team that has not turned the ball over, for running backs who have not fumbled in such a long time in so many games, that's the second one of the day for William Howard, giving Auburn the ball on the Tennessee 19-yard line.
Second Tennessee fumble, and the second time Auburn has picked up the ball. 10 minutes to go, third quarter. Auburn in excellent position to score again. Berger, forward, twisting, curling, he may go. 10-5, incredible touchdown. You talk about your second effort. You talk about strength, determination, and will to succeed. You saw it all right there. Number 22, forward, great play.
He just takes it on a straight dive play up the middle. He's got a hole really to the inside. He went to the outside instead, spun off, and that leap put him into the highlight film.
19-yard scamper for touchdown. On the field, that is Brian Hunt, the middle guard for Tennessee. Fullwood has Auburn out in front, 16-0 with 10 minutes to go in the third quarter. 9 minutes and 59 seconds to go here in the third quarter. This Auburn crowd electrified by the fine running performance from Brent Fullwood a moment ago, as you saw Brian Hunt hobbling off the field as Tennessee's injury woes continue. Chris Knapp is on for the extra point. It is good. And Auburn has a 17-0 lead. The Tigers are in control. Now to the sidelines of Michael Adams.
Outstanding defensive players for the Auburn Tigers this afternoon has been number 20, Stan Morse, who made that big stop of Tennessee's William Howard. He's a son of a very famous football player, Larry Morris, All-American at Georgia Tech back in the 50s, and of course an All-Pro linebacker with the Chicago Bears during their last 4 years, 1963. Must be kind of funny to see your son out here following in your footsteps. Good funny.
Good fun. I'm a football dad, you know. I'm proud of him. He's a good hard hitter, he's a good player, and he really likes to do it all.
How did he get away from going to Georgia Tech? I know you reside in Atlanta.
Well, he wanted to do his own thing, and he didn't want to be an engineer, so he's down here, and he's doing well.
How about the Tigers? They're putting it to Tennessee this afternoon.
I'm proud of them. This is great Southern football. Great Southern football, and Tennessee's got a fine team. Auburn's playing extremely well today.
Okay, Larry, thanks for joining us. Go upstairs. I know you had a great seat. Okay, appreciate it. Nice hat. I need this.
Larry, I remember Morris back with guys like Fortunato and Ed Obradovich and Doug Atkins and that crew back in the early 60s with the Chicago Bears. That drive, that forward score, direct result of the Tennessee turnover. It's 17-0. Anthony Miller works his way up to the 25-yard line. Lynn Swan, Tennessee's got to go to work in a hurry.
Well, they certainly do. Johnny May just told us at the beginning he didn't think a team could win the SEC with two losses. His team is trailing by 17 points. Time is slipping away from them. It's still 9:53 in the third quarter, which is a lot of time, but it's not all day for him to just casually run the football up and down the field to make up for the 17 points.
Again, it's Randy Sanders at quarterback. Play action. Rolling. That's Terrence Cleveland near midfield, runs out of bounds at the 48-yard line. Terrence Cleveland's first reception of the afternoon.
Andre Bruce was coming in from the outside on the blitz. He was picked up right there, giving Sanders the time to get to the outside. He throws well here on the rollout pass as Terrence is able to get it and stop the clock.
Randy Sanders came on strong at spring practice. In fact, hit 10 of 12 in the orange and white game, impressed a lot of folks. Here gives the handoff to William Howard. Prior to this season, Sanders had thrown only two incomplete passes in his career. Of course, came on, as we mentioned, in that Mississippi State loss. Performed well. In fact, that was his first action in that game 2 weeks ago. First real on-the-field action in like 3 years since he played high school ball back in Morristown, Tennessee. Second and six. In Auburn territory. Same kind of a play rolling. Sanders tosses, incomplete. That ball was intended for William Howard. And Andre Bruce was over there. Kurt Crane was too.
Andre Bruce runs a 4-6 in a 40-yard dash. Big, strong kid. Wasn't recruited by a lot of schools, but when he was in high school, he played tackle, wide receiver, and safety on the same football team and was selected the most valuable player in a high school basketball tournament. So they saw this kid's athletic ability and said, in time, we think he'll be a good one.
Could have been a big-time college basketball player. Tennessee 0-for-7 in third down conversions, 3rd and 6. Big, big play. Sanders tossing to nobody. Going for Klingscale. But he was nowhere close to the football. So it's fourth down again for Tennessee. Again, an opportunity, a situation where if they had made it, if they'd come through, they would have been in excellent position to move that ball and continue onward. But again, they failed to come through. 0-for-8 now in third down opportunity.
Can't win football games like that.
Garmin punting away. Auburn lets it drop, and Tennessee downs the ball at about the 4-yard line. So Auburn backed up deep in their own territory, but they have a 17-point lead with 8:44 to go here in the third quarter. All right, 17-0. 4-yard line, Auburn with the football. Berger hands off. That is forward. 20. He's going to go. 35, 40, midfield. Is he going to be caught? 30, 25, Brent Fullwood brought down at the 9-yard line by Terry McDaniel. Wow, 86 yards. Fullwood from his own 4 brings it down to the 10-yard line of Tennessee. You're looking at a big-time back.
Well, you sit there and you're waiting for them to go right up the middle. They do. They get the great blocking from the All-American center. The number 21-2, Brent Fullwood, is making strides for his own All-American candidacy as he sprints down the sideline. But, look at Terry Daniels fly. Number 86, Terry McDaniels comes up, makes a big tackle right there.
On the day, 11 carries, 169 yards, and a touchdown for number 22, Brent Fullwood, the senior out of St. Cloud, Florida. That's Tim Jesse, inside the 10, knocked out at about the 8-yard line. Kelly Ziegler, the man to do it. Wow. Take a rest there, Brent. You deserve it.
I don't want to wear out the big horse on one long play. Give him a little time to recuperate. A big 8 minutes left to go in this ball game and another quarter.
Brent Fullwood. The Fullwood watch is on. Second and 9. Big Reggie Ware pounding inside the 5-yard line. So it was the longest run, incidentally, of Fullwood's career. His previous long, 70 yards last year.
So in 3 plays, the Auburn Tigers offense takes the ball from within their own 5-yard line, goes down, and now it rests on the 5-yard line of Tennessee.
I tell you, that's the ticket.
yeah, that's it. Yeah,
just get somebody to run 85 yards. That's all you have to do.
I tell you, Johnny, you out of mind, you're shaking your head right now because you're up against a real solid offensive line there. How many times are you going to see a player, and I'll tell you not often, that's going to get an inside handoff and go to the middle of his offensive line for 86 yards, or officially 85 yards.
I'll tell you what, though, we should still make sure we give credit to those guys on that line, like Ben Tamarillo and Stacey Searles, an all-conference player as well. And okay, don't forget again, the Fighting Irish, the Crimson Tide, a week from today, right here on ABC. Notre Dame leading over Purdue, 27-0. Bama is off today, resting up for the Irish. I would think they might have a coach or two at that game today, sitting in the Irish,
sitting somewhere in the crowd.
Exactly.
Taking notes. You're right. Talking about that offensive line of Auburn. Jim Thompson, Vincent Jones, Ben Tamarillo, John Colwart, and Stacey Searles, the right tackle. All those people in the front line have really handled the defensive front line of Tennessee. They must have been thinking, boy, this is going to have to be a long, hot drive from the five-yard line, pounding it out yard by yard. All of a sudden, Brent Fullwood pulls a rabbit out of his pocket, 85 yards. He says, okay, we like it.
No kidding. Third and five. Reggie Ware in the backfield. Berger's going to throw it. Remarkable grab. Terry McDaniel supplied the coverage. The ball was loose. And Gaines, as we mentioned earlier, a fellow who has tremendous hands, great vision, a smart player, had the presence of mind to keep after and grab the football.
And let us also say courageous as he catches a pass in the crowd here, knows he's going to be hit, yet he still makes a tough catch, and the ball is between the one-yard line and the goal line.
And Pat Dye is going to go for it. Fourth and goal inside the one. Ware, Fullwood, and Agee. It's Ware up in the air. Touchdown, Auburn. Reggie Ware's second touchdown of the day on the fourth play, and Auburn has a 23-0 lead, and the rout is on. Knapp puts it up. Good. Shulman, a good job as the holder, taking care of that high snap, placing it down. The Tigers have a 24-0 lead, and Pat Dye has very little to complain about right now.
When you've got an All-American center and candidate for the Outland Trophy, like number 55, Ben Tamburello, you get in a fourth and inches situation on the goal line or any place on the football field, that's exactly where you go. Take a look. He just comes off the ball. He's in the end zone. He's made the penetration on the defensive line. Creates a situation where Timmy Ware just pops over the top.
Wow. There's that Miami-Oklahoma score in the third. And the Sooners still trailing. Nebraska easily, Michigan winning. Of course, that USC-Washington game win, I know you'll be watching that one.
Yeah, I'm pulling for USC to win. This is a real big ball game for them. They don't have any reasons now, no more excuses. And I hope they just stick it to them.
Huskies are tough, though. Huskies are tough. Incidentally, the 85-yard run from scrimmage by Brent Fullwood ties Joe Cribbs for the third longest run from scrimmage in Auburn football history, 85 yards. Anthony Miller, still on his feet. Close to the 30-yard line, the all-time record, incidentally. Ralph O'Gwynn, back in 1936 for Auburn, has the all-time record, 92 yards in the line of scrimmage. There's the drive, and obviously 85 of those 96 yards supplied by Fullwood in one very quick, impressive run.
Now that's the kind of scoring drive that Tennessee would like to have right now, what they're going to need very quick to get some points on the scoreboard for a miracle comeback here.
24-0. Sanders. That's Miller. Uh-oh, he's going the other way. Look at him go. 35-40. Tackled from behind at the 43-yard line by Brian Smith. That's the kind of play that occasionally gives coaches heart attacks. 13-yard gain, though, by Miller.
It will give you a heart attack, a cerebral hemorrhage, at least an ulcer. But when you think about it, watch how quickly this young man gets to the other side. We talked about his great speed. He's over there, nothing flat, and turns the corner. Now, if they had a little blocking out there, which they didn't because it wasn't designed to go over there, he might have gotten that one or two block he needed to get a few more yards.
He was a first-team junior college All-American at Pasadena City College in Southern California. Got away from UCLA and USC and came to Tennessee. Look out! On the run! That is Vando Davis, 25-20 inside to the 18-yard line. Dan Morris brings them down. Landry just said they need a long run like that. Vando Davis comes up with a 37-yard run. Vando Davis, that is his first carry of the season.
They've been doing this all day, going through the center of the line, but this time he gets through real clean and breaks out into the secondary and had a long, long run. A lot of green there and nobody to stop him until Shannon came over.
Not a bad way to start out your career, huh?
Not at all.
Freshman, 6 feet, 185 out of Wilmington, Delaware. This time it's Howard. And he is brought down by everybody, including Edward Phillips and Benji Rowland for Auburn.
A welcoming committee.
No kidding. Vando Davis suddenly brought to life the Tennessee fans who are in attendance here at Auburn, Alabama. 5.5 to go here in the third. And Johnny Majors and Tennessee folks here realize they got to get in the board in a hurry here.
13 shutouts. Tennessee's making a bid not to be number 14.
Second and 9. Ball on the Auburn 19-yard line. There's movement on that line.
When I watched this Tennessee team practice on Wednesday, every time a defensive lineman jumped offside, the center automatically snapped the ball, gave it to the quarterback, and he downed it on one knee so that they would get the penalty. Of course, if the defensive lineman is in the neutral zone and gets back, it's no penalty.
It's the first case. Auburn. Offside. See if we can see who it is. Is that Rocker? I believe it's Tracy Rocker.
Yep. Just jumps offside, gets into the neutral zone. The center wisely snaps the ball. Quarterback just takes it.
Defense.
Downs it. It's a 5-yard gain.
Tennessee will take it. Second and 4. Ball now on the 14-yard line.
It's an audible.
Wilson in the backfield. Along with Vando Davis, he is tripped up in a hurry. Gets back to the line of scrimmage, maybe.
One of the objectives in this ball game, Corey, was for the Auburn defense to disguise their defensive coverage and alignment, make Tennessee think one thing, then audible to something else that they were prepared for. It's been working throughout the afternoon. They've been audibling quite a bit, but every time they audible, they haven't come up with a play with the big game.
Third and 4. Johnny Majors. Sanders pitching out Howard. Gain of a yard, but he is short of the first. Andre Bruce, number 93. His teammates say this guy is crazy. All over the field. A rock'em sock'em type guy. Loves to hit people.
Well, Johnny Majors right now would like to rock and sock a few people himself. Just kind of shake them up and get them to play a little bit more intensely in this football game.
Now fourth and 2. Revaez is on for a 20-yard effort. All SEC performer who last year set the Auburn scoring record of 102 points along with Bo Jackson, but it is no good. No good. Revaez misses on the field goal attempt. Tennessee is still shut out. 24-0, 4:09 to go in the third. John Heisman, the man for whom the Heisman Trophy is named, coached football at 7 different schools, including Auburn, the only one of those schools to produce a Heisman Trophy winner. Back in 71, it's Pat Sullivan passing his way to college football's top prize. Then last year, the finest running back in Tiger history, Bo Jackson, wins the 1985 Heisman Trophy. Carlos Revaez having his problems for Tennessee today. He had made 12 consecutive field goals coming into this game. His last miss had been 7 games ago against Rutgers. He has missed 2 today, once in the second quarter from 46 yards out and once just a moment ago from 30 yards out.
But he also set out the first game of this year because of the NCAA's ruling about the tickets and misuse of tickets.
Exactly. Vincent Harris to carry. Auburn has scored on its last 2 possessions here in the third quarter. Miami,
14-3 over Oklahoma.
Hurricane
Oklahoma very susceptible to a strong passing offense, and it was only Miami. Miami was the only team that beat them last year in the national championship season.
Of course, Tennessee, your fans remember the Sugar Bowl, and the score is 35-7, Tennessee over Miami. Harris again. Powers for about three.
Well, certainly, if Pat Dye had questions about just how good their football team was, they've been answered here so far. As you take a look at the third quarter score of Notre Dame over Purdue, his team has played extremely well offensively and defensively, and now I think he's got to say, I've got a legitimate and strong contender for the SEC championship.
No question about it. Berger to Harris. Harris across the 30 to the 32-yard line. First down, Auburn. Darren Miller drove Harris out. Vincent Harris, another one of the outstanding backs in Pat Dye's stable of running backs. They got six, seven guys who can come in and get the job done. Harris came in today with 15 carries, 50 yards, and a touchdown. Very impressive in the spring drills last year. Alexander Wright's in the ballgame, by the way, Lynn. Let's see if they throw it to him, and they do at the 35. Incomplete. That pass broken up on the near side by David Poole, number 13. Making number 14, Terry Brown.
Terry Brown's not getting up.
That would be a major blow to Tennessee's secondary. They're already missing Charles Davis, all-SEC performer. Here it is again.
He goes up. He has it loose, it then comes down. You know, can't tell by the way he fell what kind of injury he may have sustained. We would hope that for his benefit that he only knocked the wind out of himself.
Terry Brown today was switched over to free safety to take the spot of Charles Davis. That was a hamstring pull. Did not make the trip here to Auburn. So the Tennessee secondary, with Brown going out, is really weak right now.
Not enough men on the line of scrimmage. Offense. First down.
5-yard penalty, make it first and 15 for the infraction.
We won't be going anywhere too soon. The player's still hurt.
That's a pretty impressive list, isn't it?
Jackson, Brooks, Cribbs, and Cribbs. I'd like to get those guys in my backfield.
I'd take them. Looks like Terry is really hurting.
Yep.
Terry Brown, a senior from Macon, Georgia. Got him up on his feet now, helping him across the field. Terry had a great game against Auburn last year. Came up with 11 tackles and covered a big fumble. That game in Knoxville, it shut down Auburn's title hopes, really, was the beginning of that.
Well, the Auburn fans happy, a little something to play about.
Sure.
Why not?
Talk about great backs, as we were just a moment ago, with guys like Cribbs and Andrews and James Brooks. Dallas Cowboys got a few and taking on the Cardinals this Monday night right here on ABC. Monday night football, 9 o'clock Eastern time. The Cardinals and the Cowboys from St. Louis.
Ward Green, perfect receiver from the Cardinals. Tough player.
Forward to the 33-yard line, and the fans, you can hear them kind of hold their breath as soon as they see Fuller in the game and the handoff going to number 22.
I like the way you called his name out that time. It's almost like
you're anticipating something
here now. And we should. We should. With 12 rushes and 176 yards, we should anticipate this man will just continue in that vein.
Second and 10. One man, David Poole, and reaches up and out for an extra 3 yards to the 40-yard line. Auburn is about 3 yards shy of the first down.
They're taking advantage of the speed of the Tennessee defensive line. He hits their hole. Brent Fullwood makes it look like he's going to go to the left and inside, then puts on a little cut, moves to the outside, and he's running away from everyone.
Harris and Fullwood in the eye. The pitch to Fullwood. He's not going to make it this time. Ziegler and Peppers to make the stop for Tennessee, and Auburn will have to punt it away. Minute 17 to go. The Tigers of Auburn in command.
Come to the first base row. Aaron Deming.
Schulman. Andre Kramer put the knee down, kept moving, but of course he goes down right there. The Auburn players and their fans are pumped up, and so is this man, Pat Dye.
Another coach in the SEC who had his roots down in Alabama. He coached alongside the great Paul Bear Bryant, as did Ken Donahue, the defensive coordinator for the Tennessee Volunteers.
I asked Pat about Ken yesterday. He said, oh, that wily old fox will come up to something to goof us up tomorrow.
Ken's tall, thin, stays in great shape, runs the stairs with his players on occasion.
Miller in motion. Sanders gives it to Miller. And the end around, Miller up close to the 30-yard line. Kevin Porter forced him out there.
Johnny Major said, we've got to create some opportunities for this young man, Anthony Miller, to get his hands on the ball, to carry it, because he is so talented and so good. I think that's what you're seeing here right now. Now, he has great control over his speed and ability. Now, I saw him in practice. He made some great pro moves in his pass routes. He picks his moments to turn on that speed. He just doesn't misuse it.
Just 37 seconds to go here in the third quarter. The Tigers trying to go 3-0 overall and 1-0 in the SEC. Have themselves a 24-point lead. Incidentally, Fullwood on the day with 182 yards for Auburn. His previous best came last year against Southwestern Louisiana with 173 yards. This is his career best afternoon. 14 carries, 182. Incidentally, entering today's game, no Auburn back had carried more times than nine in a game. Sanders, a lot of pressure. Incomplete pass. Let's throw it down now to Mike Adams.
Corey and Lynn, the word on Tennessee wide receiver Terry Brown is not as bad as it appears. He just suffered a bruised left knee. As you can see, he is walking around testing that knee. Talked to the trainer, said he could possibly get back into the game, but the last thing Johnny Majors needs right now is another injury. Corey?
No question about that. Terry Brown trying to work that leg out a little bit. It's second and 10 after the incomplete pass by Sanders. 29-yard line of Tennessee. Over the middle, it is caught. It's like Kennard McGuire, number 80, that's right. Hit immediately by Kurt Crane. And the time ticks down here in the third quarter. Tennessee Volunteers and Johnny Majors in trouble at Auburn, Alabama. If not one here story in a football game, that certainly is one major reason why Auburn is leading, I should say, 24-0.
At that time, once again, defensive lineman for Auburn jumped into the neutral zone. The center snapped the ball. They're going to pick up 5 yards here, and that's going to be enough for the first down.
All right, first time today they've come through on a third down situation, and it's not exactly on their own accord.
I don't think statistically, though, they get credit for that.
Offside, defense, first down.
Do they get that, you think?
I'm not sure. George, do they get that?
Here, George Hill. Do they get credit for that? Nope, they do not get credit for a third down conversion because of the penalty statistically.
But they'll accept it gladly. 14:50 to go in the fourth. First and 10. Tennessee. Sanders, look out. Hit hard from behind by number number 49, number 48, that is Alvin Mitchell. Outside linebacker out of Venice, Florida. Sanders had no chance, did not know he was coming.
There were two people coming around the backside. He had one blocker back there to pick him up. He had to make a choice. He took one. The other one got through.
Now
they're back to where they started when they had the first down. Three plays ago.
Second and 20 now. Of the Tennessee band members trying to keep smiles on their faces. Sanders, the fake, spins, fires, complete there. Number 35, William Howard. He's banged out of bounds immediately. Let's go to Mike Attaway now, Mike.
Well, Corey, down 24-0. Tennessee obviously could use a few good men. I'm not putting down the Volunteers this afternoon, but these guys look like football players. Boy Scout troop from Valley, Alabama. Maybe Johnny Meiser should take a look at them in the long run. In about 10 years, they'll be able to play. This guy is obviously a nose tackle. This guy's a quarterback. This guy's a middle linebacker. This guy's a running back. But I understand, even though you guys are from Valley, Alabama, you're not Auburn fans.
No, I'm Alabama.
You like Alabama, huh?
Mm-hmm.
How come?
I just like to play video all the time.
Okay, let's go back to the game. Enjoy yourself. Thanks for coming down.
Third and 17, Sanders being chased, throws on the run. It is caught, I believe, by Klingscales. It is on the 44-yard line. It's good for the first. No, it is not good for the first. Now it's about 6 yards short. Good catch again by Klingscales, Glenn, though.
Yeah, they were talking to get away from that, the actual play. Michael was talking about the future. There is one guy, they have a freshman down in Tennessee. He's number 60, named Anton Davis. This guy came in at 340 pounds. They trimmed him down. He's an offensive guard now playing on their redshirt team at about 305. And I saw him. He looks good for 305 pounds.
The new refrigerator, huh?
Next year, you hear a lot about that young man.
Timeout in the field. Auburn continues to lead. With just over 13 minutes remaining in the contest. Bob Garman to punt. Trey Gaines back to receive. Trey is calling for a fair catch at the 13-yard line. Check out a few other scores from around the country. Miami. Wow. Vinny Testaverde, another touchdown pass, we understand. It's 21-3 in the third quarter. Number 5, Michigan. Tough ball game, but they pull it out. Notre Dame, the team you will see next week. Winning today, Penn State over East Carolina, the club that Auburn took care of, 45-0 last week. Score here, 24-0, a Chris Knapp field goal in the first quarter. Reggie Ware from 1 yard out in the second. A Brent Fullwood 19-yard scamper in the third. And another Reggie Ware touchdown from short yardage after that 85-yard run by Brent Fullwood. This is James Joseph. Freshman from Phenix City, Alabama. We have high hopes for him. Pat Dye played his football at the University of Georgia. Pretty good player, too. Two-time All-SEC guard. He was the most valuable lineman in the conference back in 1960. Played in the same team with Fran Tarkenton, as a matter of fact. Co-captain. Second and 7 for Auburn. That's Gaines in motion. James Joseph trying to find some room, still on his feet, squirming and churning around.
Well, the game is at that stage where you're going to see a lot of backup players, I think, come in from Auburn and get a chance to play here against Tennessee. Show you some more scores here, Richardson, Syracuse. And this is the kind of ball game that when those backup players come in and get that experience, later on in the year, if there's an injury or a tough ball game, somebody goes out, they won't be putting in inexperienced people.
33 for the Tigers. That's Gaines in motion. The back shifting, and I believe to the illegal motion on the Tigers. Looks like left guard Stacy Town was the man to initially move. Listen in.
Dead ball. False start. Offense.
You know, and one of the things that several of the Auburn players told me about that has brought them very close together this year is the extraordinary hard work they did in the offseason. Pat Dye had these players come in for 6 weeks over the winter, and they performed Monday, Wednesday, and Friday at 6 a.m. in the morning. Strenuous training situations. This summer, they put in four workouts a day. James Joseph barreling across the 20. And they feel like that extra sacrifice, the things that they did this year they didn't do last year, has brought them closer together. Pat Dye says it's the hardest he's ever worked a football team ever. And they feel like it's going to make them a better football team, not only in terms of being in condition in the fourth quarter, but just being close as a team.
I think that kind of work will bring a team much closer. And I would have to believe it. He had four workouts a day. Some of those are just conditioning workouts in the weight room.
It's a little misleading.
Yeah,
but
that kind of thing. But those are the kind of programs that are going to help kids who are smaller build up, get a lot more size, and feel much more confident in their own abilities physically when they hit the football field.
In fact, Pat Dye even went back to two-a-day workouts in that week off they had between the UTC game and the East Carolina game. Andre Kramer, he leaps up in the air, hit hard, and still on his feet, goes out of bounds. That man just would not go down, hit about three times.
There's a flag on the play.
There's a 45-yard punt, a 10-yard return by Kramer. There is a flag. Flipping against the ball.
Another mistake that only moves Tennessee further away from giving any kind of points on the scoreboard.
So, Tennessee, we'll see if they can't get something cranked up here.
Flipping.
10 minutes, 44 seconds to go in the ball game.
I don't know. What are you going to do?
I don't know.
I'd go to college.
Me
yeah.
too.
I had the money.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do?
I don't know.
What are you going to do?
You don't want those fries. What are you going to do, Jack? Eat your way to college?
Really? I'm going to college on the new GI Bill. You serve full-time in the armed forces or part-time in the reserves, and you earn a lot of money for tuition.
The new GI Bill.
Isn't that pickle?
Now for young men and women in the armed forces, it's a great place to start. See your local recruiter.
Ago, the renewal of the Auburn Tennessee series after a 17-year lull. The star, UT's tailback, in the single wing, Johnny Majors. Johnny rushes for two touchdowns, passes for another as the Vols crush the Tigers 35-7. Majors en route to his finest year as a collegian. He would play second in the Heisman Trophy balloting. And the man who won the Heisman back in 56, of course, Paul Hornung, who played his football at Notre Dame. Johnny Majors.
Of course, in 1976, he led the Pittsburgh University team to a national championship with Tony Dorsett, Hugh Green,
and left immediately thereafter for the University of Tennessee job. Incomplete pass intended for Clint Scales from Sanders. He called that decision to leave Pittsburgh and that national program there, the national title he had developed, as one of the most traumatic things he's ever had to do.
I'm sure. Living a national championship, players you recruited to build that program, and then he's coming back home to Tennessee.
Baseball coming up, of course, the league championship series. American League begins on the 7th, the National League in the 8th. Who do you like?
I like Boston and I like the Mets.
All right.
But Boston has to get there first, one game away.
That's right. Charles Wilson. Wilson, the young man who broke his forearm early in spring camp. He's back earlier than anticipated. Junior out of Pritchard, Alabama. You see Miami and Oklahoma scored their first touchdown of the game moments ago.
the third quarter. They're still capable of coming back. They have a shot. The way that offense, they can break something open in a hurry. Like this one needs to break something open in a hurry. For
third and three, exactly. 10 minutes to go in the game.
Wilson, you see the big cast on his arm there, and he is whipped to the ground by Tracy Rocker.
Another third down situation. They failed to convert. You know, when Johnny Majors gets this unit back to Tennessee, he is going to have a few words for them about not being able to convert on third down. Johnny Majors will, and of course, his offensive coordinator, Walt Harris, who is from El Camino, California, neighborhood that I lived in, and he coached over at Berkeley with Mike White, coached with him at Illinois, fashioned this offensive unit much like that of Cincinnati's and San Francisco.
They finally made a big play. That ball was down. It is not a fumble. Howard comes through up to the 40-yard line on the fourth down play, the first time Tennessee has made a fourth down situation. They have been 0 for 3 and 0 for 10 in the third down conversion department, so their first clutch opportunity they come through on.
That's right. That's been those stats you'll remember they would like to forget that they converted on one fourth down opportunity and none of the third down opportunities.
Howard, who produced 71 yards in the first half, only 14 yards in the second half. He's got 85 for the game. Sanders, quick pass. This is Miller, the man we told you about. Across midfield, what speed he has. And he's still on his feet. To the 20. He's going to go, I think. 10, 5, touchdown. Anthony Miller, this is the young man we've been talking about all day. 60 yards for the score. The junior college All-American, Lynn Swan says, has got big-time football play written all over.
And that time, he shows some of his ability, and is with a little help from his friends, when he was losing his balance, he's able to go the distance 60 yards for the touchdown. Now, this is a very popular play with the Tennessee football team. Auburn knew they were going to run this quite a bit, but to get the people out in front, right there, he's almost knocked down, but he gets a little help.
That's Vince Carter, number 9, supplying the help.
He keeps him up. Number 4 comes over to make a tackle, but he's already in the end zone.
Impressive performance. Anthony Miller, he had been the yardage leader coming into this game with nearly 150 yards to the end. That is Tennessee's first touchdown pass of the year. In fact, the two games last year, Tennessee had compiled 6 touchdown passes.
And with the more immediate in mind, the first points for the Tennessee football team this afternoon.
That is for sure. But we got a taste of what Tennessee fans have to look forward to. This young man
came in from Pasadena City College. He's a junior college transfer. He's got a couple more years. Of course, once again, next week, Notre Dame taking on Alabama. That's going to be a pretty good matchup. I look for Notre Dame to try and make or salvage the early part of the season with a big win over Alabama. Well, Alabama's not going to give it to them, of course.
No, they sure aren't. And it's at Legion Field, too, which does not make that task any easier.
Cornelius Bennett, their big linebacker.
Oh,
All-American linebacker. No old presence, Phil.
Yeah, we talked to Pat Dye about that game coming up next week. And I can tell you who we'd like to win, but I can also tell you who we think is going to win.
I'm sure he would like to see Alabama lose, have some of the steam taken out of them. Another happy co-ed out here.
All right, Tennessee at the timeout. They're going for 2. It's 24-6. Need all the points they can get in the backfield. High formation. You got Miller and you got Howard. Quarterback continues to be Randy Sanders, shouting instructions. That's Howard, straight up the gut, diving through, and he gets it. The two-point conversion works for Tennessee. Johnny Majors not conceding yet. So, Tennessee, with 8 points on the board, 16 points behind. Question is there time enough left to get back in the game? 24-8 Tigers.
To photo photograph the Earth's resources from the air, they say you need a camera that can see through clouds.
Bad chance.
Can't be done.
But Goodyear said,
let's try a new way.
And developed a special kind of radar.
Goodyear?
Yeah, the Aerospace Group.
Radar that not only sees through clouds, but gives you pictures as sharp as some cameras. Good thing we didn't listen to what they say.
The way I see it, people used to know about nature, respected it, then they figured they'd try to make it better. Take beer. Can you imagine why anyone would want to add anything artificial to something that just comes naturally from ingredients like grain, water, barley, hops? Neither can Coors.
Television premiere. Raiders of the Lost Ark. Join the adventure Sunday.
Tennessee Volunteer fans here at Auburn, Alabama have come alive a little bit with 8:37 to go. Anthony Miller and Randy Sanders hook up. Sanders' first touchdown toss. Miller's first touchdown reception. In fact, Tennessee's first TD reception of the year. It's an onside kick as we anticipated. Scramble is on. Who knows who's got it? The referee will tell us.
It was very close. The kicker looked like he was trying to get in front of it.
That's James Joseph with a football. And Auburn has got the ball in Tennessee territory. But Johnny Majors had no choice. They had to go for that.
And what you like about sports and competitive people is that even though there's only 8 minutes or so to play in the ball game, they're down by 16 points. They went for two to make it 24-8, so that in theory they score twice, they score the conversion by two, it's a tie ball game, and they can win. So you see Miami winning big now, 27-10 over Oklahoma. Fourth touchdown pass for Vinny Testaverde. Got to be a great afternoon for him in the bid for a Heisman Trophy.
Sensational outing. Of course, talking about sensational outings, let's not forget number 22. In blue, his name is Brent Fullwood. Career high, 14, 182 yards on those 14 carries. And this is Fullwood again. He's got some room right side, and he bounds up close to the 30-yard line, a first down. Brent Fullwood putting on a show here at Auburn. Let's go down to Mike Adamley on the sideline.
You know, Corey and Lynn, college band members are a little bit like Rodney Dangerfield. They work hard, they're tireless, they're talented, but nobody gives them no respect at all. Scott Eaves is a band member, he's a drummer, an engineering major, and you've got to be hot. This is all wool.
That's right. It's about 20 or 30 degrees hotter than it is for everybody else sitting up here. It's terrible.
Well, after that Anthony Miller touchdown, the pride of the Southland band finally has something to beat their drums about.
Yeah!
Go ahead.
Hey, Mike, can you bring that hat up for us?
Oh, Larry Morris's hat? You got it. Absolutely.
I think Lynn wants to wear that hat home tonight. 8 minutes and 10 seconds to go in the fourth quarter. Auburn with a football on the 27-yard line of Tennessee. Brent Fullwood, take a look at this. 15 rushes, 196 yards, just shy of that 200-yard mark. His career best. Couple more yards towards that 200-yard mark. Brent Fullwood, quite an afternoon. Kelly Ziegler brought him down there. They're going to get an idea of some of the haircuts that these Auburn kids have decided to show off around campus. They had a midnight raid here about 10 days ago.
And they actually volunteered for it.
33. Over 200 yards on the day. Victor Pepper stops him there, but Fullwood, nobody is really stopping him today.
Okay, in an effort, he's got 17 carries for 207 yards. In an effort to stay on top of the Fullwood watcher this afternoon,
How many of you might guess what the most yards for an afternoon is for the Auburn Tigers?
307.
How, by George, you've got it, Corey. That was in 1944 on 33 carries by Curtis Kuykendall versus Miami.
Tommy Agee. Stacked up at about the 13-yard line. Mike Kelly is there.
Of course, after that phenomenal day that Curtis had, it reached 290 yards by Bo Jackson, 256 by Bo Jackson, 250 by Joe Cribb.
You know, you go a little further down that line, and some people might be surprised to see Tommy Agee's name up there among the top eight or nine performers of all time, single game yardage, 219 yards against Maryland back in 83. This time, Fullwood's going to lose a yard. Hovannik, Tennessee's big play man.
I've got to tell you this, Corey. We talked about this before. You know, I was born just outside of Knoxville, Tennessee. My grandmother wanted me to be a Tennessee volunteer, but the Trojans got to me first.
You know, Johnny Majors almost attended Auburn. He was all set to go, and his mother kind of talked him out of it, as I understand. Berger to the air, the end zone. It is incomplete. That ball intended for Lawyer Tillman. Covering is Terry McDaniel.
Well, certainly with a 16-point lead, there is no letdown, and the Auburn Tigers onslaught. They want to increase this lead. They put the ball in the air, although incomplete, into the end zone.
Chris Knapp comes on to attempt what appears to be a 30-yard field goal. Knapp with one field goal already today, a 36-yarder back in the first quarter. Again, from 30 yards, the place down, it is up, it looks good from here, and it is. Chris Knapp, good from 30 yards out, his second field goal of the afternoon, as Auburn increases its lead by 3 points, 27-8 our score, just over 5 minutes to go in the fourth. We'll be back. Perfect showcase today against the number one team to have a day like that. Ball bouncing into the end zone. Miller will not bring it out. Tennessee's football on the 20.
We have to believe that the coaches of Miami had to be somewhat pleased at not having to have a problem of deciding which quarterback to play since Bernie Kosar decided to leave Miami early and pursue a professional football career, opening the door for Vinny Testaverde to go in without any kind of controversy.
Very true. So Tennessee, they're down 27-8, 5 minutes and 13 seconds to go. Randy Sanders trying to take advantage of this time to prove that perhaps he should be the Volunteers' number one quarterback. He's being pressured, throwing on the run, completes that pass, I believe. Vando Davis, the man, incomplete pass, setting up a second and 10.
Comparison of the rushing yards, Auburn 291 to 108. Brilliant day of Brent Fullwood. 210 yards, that 291 receiver.
A day Brent Fullwood will remember for a long, long time. For Klingscales on the near side.
Klingscales actually did break open on that play going to the outside. Sanders had to scramble a little bit, and then showing that he is a smart receiver, when he saw his QB scrambling, he came back to him, but still they weren't able to connect on the pass. So I asked Sanders if he thought the decision for him to be a starting quarterback, not just a guy to fill in, would be based on his ability to throw the football or his leadership. And he felt probably more on his leadership. To get the job done. As long as he could win a ball game, he didn't care how you won it, whether you threw the ball or whether you handed it off.
Third and 10. Johnny Majors tells me both quarterbacks extremely smart, conscientious.
hardworking and a very difficult decision to choose between the two. Clint Scales again, the ball underthrown, sets up a 4th and 10 for Tennessee. Sanders thus far, 6 of 13 for 116 yards and one touchdown. The majority of that yardage coming on that 60-yard play to Anthony Miller, the one touchdown Tennessee has come up with today.
There's enough time on the clock where they really need a good punt. Almost blocked there to keep Auburn back.
Up to the 47-yard line. 41-yard punt. Return of 7 yards by Gainis. 4:39 to go. Take a look at what's transpired so far today. Chris Knapp, first quarter, connects on a 36-yard field goal. Reggie Ware, the designated short yardage runner from 1 yard out, makes it a 10-0 game. Then third quarter, Brent Fullwood, that brilliant 19-yard run for touchdown. Third quarter, Reggie Ware, another 1 yard run. And of course, the Anthony Miller 60-yard connection from Sanders makes it 24-8. Tennessee connecting on the 2 yard conversion. William Howard taking it over. And James Joseph across midfield. He's rolling to the 37-yard line. James Joseph, a parade All-American last year in high school, finally forced out by Mike Whitehead. And from that run, you can see why the Auburn coaching staff is so high on this young man.
Well, he just wants to call some attention to himself and say, don't forget me. I'm here and I'm capable. When I get the opportunity, I'll show you I can do the job. And he gets out of bounds, stops the clock, says, I want to have enough time left to score in this ball game.
He rushed for nearly 1,600 yards and scored 18 touchdowns in high school last year. Phoenix City, Alabama. Joseph again reversing direction. Nice little move to avoid the tackler, but gets only a couple. Whitehead again, a tackler for Tennessee. 4:12 to go here in the fourth quarter as the shadow continues to fall across the field here at Jordan-Hare Stadium, almost completely covering the field at this point.
The grounds crew does an excellent job on this field. It's immaculate. Yesterday they were out trimming just a little bit more of the grass to make it a fairly fast football field. And as good as it looks, it doesn't have all the plumbing and stuff underneath it to keep it in such great shape.
Joseph again crunching his way inside the 30 to the 28 where Milton Gordon puts the hit on. You see the clock ticking now. Here's Auburn trying to go 3-0 on the year. Last year with Bo Jackson and company, a disappointing season for the Tigers, finishing at 8-4 overall, 3-3 in the SEC. Good for a fifth place finish. They'd like to do a whole lot better this year. Now, today's performance, it looks like they may have a chance to do exactly that. Timeout in the field as Jeff Berger trots over to the near side. It's 27-8. Tigers in command. Corey McFerrin, Lynn Swan, and Mike Adamley at Auburn, Alabama. Jordan-Hare Stadium, where several thousand of the original 72,000 plus have already made their way to the exit. Auburn with a 27-8 advantage. Bolton in motion. He gets the ball on the reverse, and he's got a lot of open field ahead. To the 20, to the 15, and he's hit there by Kelly and Terry McDaniel.
Number 86, Terry McDaniel, he was the only man out there to even stop him on this play. The reverse is working very well here because of the pursuit of Tennessee. He takes the ball. McGannis is back there fighting off two people, big linemen. He makes a great tackle here for him, picking up that leg, trying to make a wish. His wish is for more points, but he just didn't get it. 15 yards on the play.
We cannot tell who that is. That's 85, Lawyer Tillman. That may be Bolton who made the play. It is Scott Bolton. 6 foot, 185 pound junior out of Theodore, Alabama. Young man who made that big catch
early in the game to set up the first touchdown by Reggie Ware. Lynn, Monday night.
Monday night football.
Cowboys, Cardinals.
Always something special.
Nighttime game, the lights, Dallas Cowboys. I mean, and the players, I mean, they say it's just another game, but it's not. They love it because everybody's watching.
Yeah, they may say it's just another game, but it's not. If not for the good reasons, then for the negatives of the fact that they sit around all day and wait for a game that they don't normally have to wait for on a Sunday afternoon.
Joseph gets the call. Backed up immediately. 2:35 to go. As Auburn works it inside the 15-yard line, they may have a chance to put on a few more points before this day is out. Eighth-ranked team in America, the Auburn Tigers. Brent Fullwood. This will be a day that Auburn fans will remember not only for the victory over Tennessee, a major, major rival of the Auburn Tigers, but also because of the performance of number 22, Brent Fullwood. That was Vincent Harris on the carry there. One or 2 minutes to go at Auburn, Alabama. I think the Tigers are exacting revenge for last year's bitter defeat up in Knoxville. This will be Pat Dye's 99th career win. Pat Dye began his head coaching career at East Carolina. From there, spent a year at Wyoming. He's now in his sixth season at Auburn. Joseph through the 10, inside the 5 for the first down. As the clock continues to tick down, Auburn looks like they're going in again. In fact, in that entire coaching career for Pat Dye, he's only had one losing season. That came up back in 1981, his first season at Auburn. .105 to go. Auburn Tigers less than a minute away from kicking off their SEC command in the right fashion, at least the right fashion as far as Tiger fans are concerned. They'll go on next week to play Western Carolina right here. Vincent Harris again, not quite there. Auburn should get one more playoff.
Well, I think if we're going to pick a Chevy player of the game, it's easy. When you look at the Auburn side, it's going to go to number 22, Brent Fullwood.
No question about that.
Terrific afternoon. Of course, when you look at the other side, a little more difficult. But we think that number 86, Terry McDaniels, the cornerback for the Tennessee Volunteers, is going to get the $1,000 scholarship from Chevrolet to go into the general academic fund of their universities.
He's been all over the place, and here's a classy move from Pat Dye. Touchdown! What happened, I am not sure. It's Berger, who simply dove over, and I'm a little confused what happened. It appeared as if Berger was stepping away from the line, but simply went down very low, waited, and simply said, what the heck, I'm going to try to sneak through. Nobody's tackling him at this point.
Well, all he's trying to do is run out the clock and just use it up. He doesn't want to get hit, and everybody stood around.
He said, why not?
They were crowding in around him. Then he just moved forward.
I think that's exactly what happened. I think initially they said, hey, let's not run it up. Let's just run out the clock right now. He said, nobody's touching me. I'm standing here. Let's play football and dive it across.
As they scored the extra point to make it 31 points for the Auburn Tigers. 34 for the Auburn Tigers. I think it's a fault of the Tennessee defense. They've got to go over there and touch him to make sure he's down. All they had to do was touch him. But everyone stood there.
This is very, very unusual. Berger on the touchdown to make it 34-8. Let's look at it one more time, see if we can't see it. It looked to me as if his knee might have actually touched the ground before the football went over the plane of the goal.
Well, he's hiding behind all these guys, and that's him just struggling out. His knee does come down right there, but the question would be whether or not the ball was over the plane. As he touches, I don't think the ball was over the plane. It looked like it may have been short.
That's one of the most unusual plays I've seen in a long time.
Oh, it's a lackadaisical play.
Sure it is.
It is because Tennessee just stood there and allowed him to back up and made no movement towards the quarterback to down him at all.
And the only time you're ever going to see a play like that is when there's 10 seconds or left to go. We've got 3 seconds to go here at Auburn, Alabama. When we finish up here, and we'll do so in just a few moments, we're going to join the Notre Dame-Purdue game also in the fourth quarter.
I think right here, Auburn's just going to hit a little squib kick, make some of the guys up front take the ball, touch it, the clock will start, and the game will be over.
That's Jim Miller for Tennessee. That clock runs out. Auburn has its revenge from last year's bitter defeat at Knoxville, and they've got it big. 34-8 the score. Your star of the game, Brett Fullwood, number 22, as Johnny Majors and Pat Dye talk things over. Have gone head-to-head for many, many years. A final score here from Auburn, Alabama, 34-8. The Tigers win it big. Brett Fullwood leads the way.
Okay.
Our Chevrolet players of the game, no question about on the Auburn side, as Lynn mentioned a moment ago, Brent Fullwood for the day, 18 carries, 207 yards, and the touchdown for Tennessee. We're going to give it to number 86, Terry McDaniel, an outstanding day in the secondary. He was all over the field today. Fullwood and McDaniel are Chevrolet players of the game this afternoon.
I think certainly Johnny Majors will go back to look at his football team, try and get those people injured, back into the game, and improve and salvage the rest of the season. But for Pat Dye in Auburn, with a score of 34-8 here in Auburn, Alabama, he has a real football team on his hands, one that's going to contend strongly for the SEC championship. And I think he's just going to go back and say, okay, guys, we've got it. Let's improve upon it. We have to get better and better as each game progresses so that we're ready for the big games against Alabama, which looms in the future.
When we started this telecast, we mentioned Auburn's efforts this year to mount a passing attack. We saw a little bit of that in the first half, but of course, once they got that lead, there was no need really to push that pass too much. But Auburn does have that capability, which makes them a more dangerous football team this year overall. The Auburn coaching staff very pleased with that and pleased with the progress of Pat Sullivan and the quarterback, Jeff Berger. The Auburn Tigers are for real, the eighth best team in the nation. An easy winner today, 34-8.